Sandra all the time is here with a cold heart true. She's the ears and the eyes for me and you. Every day, everyone want to hear from Sandra. And every time on the air, she's getting better. Tell your sister, tell your brother, tell your mama, call Sandra. In the morning and in the evening, they always calling, calling Sandra. And when they start fighting, they calling Sandra. And it's
that's right, folks. Everyone is telling their mama about the cold hard truth. Welcome to another episode with more truth telling, more problem solving, and of course, more tea spilling than ever before. Sit back, students, grab your tea and turn up the volume because class is now in session. Call in at 936-2626 because your voice matters. Share your opinion on issues that matter the most to you.
Sandra all the time is here with a cold heart true. She's the ears and the eyes for me and you. Every day, everyone want to hear from Sandra. And every time on the air, she's getting better. Tell your sister, tell your brother, tell your mama, call Sandra. In the morning and in the evening, always calling, calling Sandra. And when they start fighting, they calling Sandra. And it's
that's right, folks. Everyone is telling their mama about the cold hard truth. Welcome to another episode with more truth-telling, more problem-solving, and of course, more tea spilling than ever before. Sit back, students, grab your tea and turn up the volume because class is now in session. Call in at 936-2626 because your voice matters. Share your opinion on issues that matter the most to you. Alrighty, folks. Happy Friday. You guys are slow to wake up this morning. I see you. Let's see who's here. We're going to do roll call in just a second. Good morning, everybody on Instagram. Miss Joy Ebanks, Casey Whitaker. Who else we got over there? The names I can recognize. Lenovia. Yes. KK Scott. Good morning. Kierna, don't know what the rest of that name is supposed to be. Cayman Braca, I see you. Ronald, thank you, thank you. Y'all be picking some crazy IG names. Erica, hey, Erica. Erica, did you get engaged? I saw you played an April Fool's Day joke on us about a pregnancy, but then I see you lovey-dovey and hugging up somebody. You know we want the sus fam. Tell us what's going on. Things looking good there. Nice, handsome young man. But more importantly, does he treat you good? That's all I need to know. All right. Oh, honey child, who's this calling me? Let me plug in the show phone. Okay. Hold on. Oh. Good morning, caller. Hello? Caller? Oh, can't hear you. Uh-oh. Oh. All right. The phone wasn't plugged in. Let me plug it back in. Hey, Blake and Aaron. Good morning. Where is everybody this morning? All right. So I'm going to send out some links to our WhatsApp people so that All of them.
Big news. I have some important news for you.
Interesting news.
It's Blake and Aaron's Spilling the Tea with Sandy.
K-Man's top news headlines of the day from CMR.
Happy Friday, Sandy. How are ya?
You?
Hey, Blake and Aaron. How are you guys doing?
Good.
All right. I love that it's Friday.
Finally.
Yes. It was a short week. All right. So a couple things making headlines this beautiful Friday morning. Mm-hmm. So first of all, a U.S. veteran was fined $22,000 for bringing a loaded magazine into the Cayman Islands. And when I say magazine, I do not mean Reader's Digest.
No. And what's crazy about that story is that how did it get through? He had it on his carry-on luggage, right?
Really?
Mm-hmm. So how did it get through TSA check?
Good question.
You know what? I don't think that they care. I'm going to be very, very honest with you. When you're exiting the U.S., as long as it's not an explosive, all the other stuff they're going to leave for when you get to the other side.
Nah.
Well, I don't know. That. Well, it was covered in his backpack.
They would have taken that for sure.
Well, I find that hard to believe that TSA did not see it. Anyway, he told the police that he'd placed the magazine in his backpack while traveling in the U.S. and forgot to remove it. That's always an excuse. Before traveling to the Cayman Islands.
Because TSA doesn't know where you're going. They're just screening people going through. They don't know where everybody's going. He could have gone to a destination in the United States. They don't know that he's going.
But that's the thing. Can you take bullets? He didn't have a gun. He just had bullets.
No,
right?
You can't have bullets in your backpack or luggage.
I didn't think so.
You have to.
This happens. You know what? I'm going to try to talk to somebody who really is in the know because this happens all the time. They allow Americans to come through with weapons, and I cannot believe that they're missing all these on the other end. Like, I find that
possible.
Ammunition is prohibited in carry-on baggage.
Yeah, and if you're depending on,
it may be transported in checked baggage.
Correct, but you have to let the airline know that you're checking a weapon. You have to have permission first, and if you don't, then you get in trouble.
Mm-hmm.
So, what airline was it?
It doesn't say, but my gosh.
I'll try to find out because
it's pretty wild that it happens quite frequently. I mean, we need to figure this out. Somebody at TSA is not doing their job.
Oh, yes, but don't worry.
Stuff gets missed all the time, I'm sure.
Of course, but I had a little newborn baby and I had formula and I had it pre-mixed and, they had to test all of that just in case.
Mm.
Let's bullets go through.
Yeah, it's pretty wild.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, all right. Well, this is one of the largest fines, $22,000, and he was also ordered to pay costs of $500. And Chief Magistrate Anton Hernandez instructed that the loaded magazine be destroyed. The most interesting thing about this, though, is $22,000 might sound like a lot of money, but if he was a Caymanian, he'd be looking at 7 to 10 years in jail.
Wow.
Yeah.
The law needs a little bit of shaping up here because visitors seem to get a pass that locals definitely do not get. All right, another court case. Man has been found guilty of animal cruelty and dog's death. Of course, we were horrified by this case when it happened. Mm-hmm. The owner of Poor Little Wilbur, I know you guys remember this case, was found suffering in Prospect last year and unfortunately later passed away. Warlito Damasco Samelo Jr., age 48, was charged with animal cruelty and he was found guilty and he refused to attend his trial.
Yeah, let's talk about this. So he refused to show up. He refused to show up. The judge continued anyways, went on.
Yep, found him guilty in his absence.
Yep, and coming out of that trial, found out that this is not the first time he's done that to a dog.
Unbelievable.
So what's happening to this guy?
He could face, so that was just the guilty phase, but he now will have sentencing. So he could face up to 1 year in prison for the offense. And this is horrible.
And is he on a work permit?
Oh, yes. He is a Filipino national.
Okay. So then why is there not a deportation order? Not only that, this is the second.
Well, they have to finish
the other dog.
They have to wrap up the case first.
Okay.
And then he could be subject to a deportation.
Yeah, because he won't have a clean record now.
Yeah. And if he gets the 1 year sentence, then he's definitely out of here.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully they have his passport because he could be a flight risk. He probably want to leave anyway.
Yeah, what a terrible human.
Yeah.
How does it work with the guy with the magazine? Is he So you have to stay on island until he pays the fine, or could he just? Oh,
that's
he does.
Yeah, that's how it works. You pay your fine, and so he's probably scrambling for maybe. Oh, wow. I mean, I don't know. He's a veteran, so I don't know what his he's a U.S. Army veteran. I don't know what his financial position is. It's entirely possible that he might just have that kind of money laying around. Who knows? But as soon as he pays it, then he can leave the jurisdiction.
Okay. Wow.
A retired U.S. Army lieutenant colonel. I mean, who? It's like, dude, how do you forget to do this?
Yeah.
Anyway, Terry Toraka. Sorry, is his name. I don't understand how people leave stuff in luggage like that. Not a colonel.
I mean, highly decorated, but he's also got to be like, you know, pretty smart guy to be lieutenant colonel.
Yeah. Well,
just a very bad idea.
Yeah, you know? That's crazy. All right.
Brazen.
An educational report has come out that's not looking good for government schools. I think the Honorable Premier Juliana O'Connor-Connolly should redirect the $50 million that she's thinking about spending for less than 200 kids, because this report basically says that 74% of primary school students are failing.
Wow. Jeez.
This is according to a data report published by the Department of Education Services and the Ministry of Education. Only 26% of children leaving government primary schools achieve the expected standard in reading, writing, and mathematics.
That's insane.
That's beyond insane. That's next level. Like, wow. Like, we should all be taking a pause this morning and going, really?
Yeah.
This is, you know.
I know early childhood education, we're in the throes of it. You are too. I mean, it's hard, but. You know, I work.
But it's so important. It's like
pride. Constantly with our kids, reading, writing, doing math.
Yeah.
No, people don't.
Because you're setting the foundation for your kids.
Yes, and you need to sit down, and you need to be involved in your child's education as well.
Mm-hmm.
As a parent,
it's definitely parenting too. Part of that,
for sure. Mm-hmm. So we're going to delve into that in the coming days here on the program.
Yeah.
Wow.
Wish I had better news for you on that front. Any good things on your end? You got anything for me?
You know what? I got something for you. Today's Friday.
And we got Taste of Cayman on the show today. So make sure some tickets will probably be given away.
Week away.
All right. Well, all right. Have a great weekend. We'll see you
Thank
Monday.
You. Thank you. Have all a good
see
one.
You. See you later.
Bye-bye.
All right. Oof.
All right. Happy Friday, guys. Let me just pull everybody out of the studio. There we go. They pull themselves out. Perfect. All right. Happy Friday. Let me just go ahead and it's going to be a busy day for me. I see people calling me and I'm not sure if they're calling because they want to tell me something on the show or what's going on. So let me just call this person back and see what's going on. Mm-hmm. Yes, honey, chill. Uh-huh. Okay.
Hello.
Yes, my dear. What's going on? Live on radio.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I was violated in the car park in Camana Bay yesterday.
When you say violated, what do you mean exactly? What does that mean?
This guy came up to me. He took my purse and then he grabbed my boobs and I ran off. I went over to the security center in Camana Bay, and the police still have not done anything, nothing.
So after this happened, you went to the police station in Georgetown, or?
Yep, Georgetown. Yep.
And you filed a report. What time yesterday did this happen?
At about I want to say 1:30, maybe.
In the afternoon.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. So a random guy just walked up to you in the car park. Where exactly were you in? I know Cabana is pretty big.
Get this. Because it wasn't on CMR. The guy told me, he's like, it's not on camera right now, but they actually had two different places that have been
Which guy said this? I'm not clear. Which guy are you talking about? The police said this or who?
The security guard.
Oh.
He said to me, he's like, they have two different places. So you know that little what's it called? Ice cream shop on the corner.
Ice cream shop. Okay, so in Camana Bay, there's Häagen-Dazs, and there's the gelato place.
Yes. Okay. Gelato, and then also next door to that is also a little children's center or whatever. This is the same guy. So anyway, today I'm supposed to see with the police, and I can recognize this guy because you know what, he had a hoodie on, but when he assaulted me in the car park, I'm like, everything's on camera. So
okay.
So I'm hoping that we can catch this guy.
Yeah, I mean, they have pretty good security there at Camana Bay. I mean, they do seem to have a lot of cameras. So any sort of initial description of what he looks like?
Yep. Okay. So first of all, he's super tall. Like I want to say like maybe 6 foot. He's very tall. He's very slim. Okay. I want to say Jamaican. And he loiters out there. And I'm like, I cannot believe, like, yeah, he came up behind me. He grabbed my purse. So at first, I didn't even know what was happening to me. I was like, oh my God. And then I said to him, I'm like, take my purse. I'm like, I don't care. And then he started groping me. And that's when I ran. And I ran straight to the Camana Bay center. And that's when I said to them, I'm like, oh my God. I'm like, this guy just violated me and whatever. And so... I don't know. Today, the police are going to give me some profile pictures of some people that they think that guy is. I don't know.
Okay. All right. So if you believe that if you see him again, you'd be able to identify him, yes?
Oh, yeah, totally. Yeah. Yep. But the thing is, and I hate to say it, but because I'm an expat, that's why I said to the police officer, I'm like, is it okay if I identify him? I'm like, I'm an expat, and he's like, it's okay. It's like, I don't know what my rights are.
Okay. You have the right as anybody else, obviously, to be safe in this community. I mean, you know, this is not a country where just because you're an expat or not that you should be assaulted, to be clear. I think the most important thing is trying to find this guy and get him off the streets, because this is a pretty bold move for someone to just come and grab you up. I mean, that's pretty shocking, actually.
But apparently this guy is known for doing this, and that's the thing, like no one has said anything about him. I'm like,
so they seem to know who he is and that he has a history of this type of behavior.
Yes, that's the crazy part.
I mean, is he somebody on drugs? I mean, this sounds like somebody who's crazy.
And that's the crazy part. I'm like, and that's what I said. I was like, oh my God. I'm like, even when I talked to the police today, I was like, oh my God. I'm like, no, yesterday. When I talked to the police, I was like, oh my God. I'm like, you guys know who this person is.
Mm-hmm.
But they need someone to identify him and I can't believe I was jumped in the afternoon, Sandy. Mm-hmm. In the afternoon.
Yeah, this is pretty wild. I mean, like broad daylight, 1 o'clock in the afternoon. You think?
Yeah. I just came from one of my sales calls, and in the middle of the afternoon.
Wow. All right. Well, we're gonna reach out to the folks over at Caymana Bay, see if we can get something. So you filed a police report. Did they indicate how long it would be before you could hear something from them, or?
Well, no. I'm actually meeting with the police officer this afternoon at 10 o'clock. So.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But even still, they knew full on that this guy has been there, and no one said anything.
So when you say that, who's they knew? The police knew?
No, Caymana Bay. Shit. I don't want to get myself in
language
trouble.
Language on the radio. But you're saying that he's known to them. And so you think that they should have done something in terms of removing him from the property. That's what you're saying.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know how that works. Like, I don't know if they have, I don't think they have AI technology yet to alert them when, persona non grata is on property. They probably rely on people who say, hey, this person's loitering around, hanging out, that sort of thing. But we can certainly ask them what their procedure is.
Nope. Okay. So when I went there, when I ran and I went to, the place over in Caymana Bay, they knew exactly who I was talking about. And then when I talked to the police officers, they said to me, they're like, yeah, Tracy, we know who they are. And he's like, all we need is an offense. And I'm like, what's an offense? I'm like, I don't understand what that means.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, oh, you know, as long as there's an offense. And I'm like, okay, well, I'm sorry. This guy grabbed my bag and freaking groped me. And I freaking ran off. And I'm like, how is that not an offense? I'm like, I don't understand.
Yeah, that's more than one offense, actually. But so I would be surprised to hear that the police actually said that. That's there's multiple offenses there. So he I'm taking it he still has your bag. Nobody's recovered your bag.
No, nothing. No, nothing yet. Wow. That's why I was up all night, because I was just scared of the fact that he has my license and he knows where I live. And I'm like, thank God I live in a gated community that he can't get in here without a code. But honestly, I'm like, it's just unreal. I don't understand. And that's why I said to the police officer, I was like, my guess, I'm like, I just want to make sure that I'm safe. Mm-hmm. Like, it's just me and my dog right now. And I'm like, you know, I don't understand.
Mm-hmm.
But they knew this guy has been like, he's broken into several places in Caymana Bay and everywhere, and they all know who he is. I'm like, why are they not arresting him? I'm like, why is he still free? I'm like, I don't get it.
I guess he actually has to do something first, and it sounds like he's finally done something. So we'll see if we can reach out to the RCIPS and Caymana Bay to see what they say. And in the meantime, you know, I would say.
Well, I'm meeting with the police. I'm meeting with the police at 10 o'clock today. And hopefully he's going to show me a few pictures, and he's going to tell me what guy is what guy. But even still, I'm like, okay, so great. I identify the person, but are you going to catch him?
Like, well, I mean, hopefully they have CCTV footage at Caranha Bay. That, I'm sure that area is covered pretty well. And since it was broad daylight, there should be no issues about that having been captured on camera. And as soon as they have that, they can put out a APB for him.
No, they have everything on camera. No, they already showed me. Like, yeah, they have everything on camera, but they don't have this guy because he had a hoodie on, but I saw his face. And I'm telling you, I'm like, I freaking gave him a black eye, thank God. But yeah.
So you were able to hit him? You got in a little punch?
Oh, damn straight. No, I was flailing when he came up behind me. So I was walking to my car, and then he grabbed my purse, and I went behind him, and I took my right hand and I freaking mashed him in his eye. So I know he has a black eye, whoever he is. And then I ran, because then he grabbed my boob, and and I was scared of being raped, and I ran off. And that's when I ran to the place over in Caranha Bay where they have
this was in the parking lot, or let me try to get a visual of exactly which of the parking lots is this, because there's the one that's kind of has the covered area, and then there's like service parking and stuff that's close to the gelato, but then there's like a back end of that over by more closer to the school.
This is the one by
closer to the school.
Jesse Juice. There's
but that's not close to gelato. That's closer to Haagen-Dazs than the gelato place. Hello, Tracy?
I was saying
that's not close to the gelato store, so that's why I'm a little bit confused. That's closer to the Haagen-Dazs store in terms of ice cream.
Yeah, by the cinema.
Oh, that's a really busy parking lot. Did other people see this happen?
No one was there. That's the strange thing. I'm like, there was no security guard. There was nobody was there.
Huh. Yeah, there was a security guard who stands up right there by Haagen-Dazs.
Yep.
So no one was coming in and out of the gym. No one was coming out of the juice place. Nope. The security guard by the crosswalk, because there's another one that stands up all day by the crosswalk, making sure people are crossing safely. That little street there. I don't know what that street's called. So he wasn't there.
No, and that's what Paige said to me. Paige is my friend. And she said to me, she's like, oh my God, because I just finished doing my sales call on that. And I literally walked across the street, and then he grabbed me, and I'm like, I still cannot believe, like, even the CCTV footage, I want to share that with you, because I'm telling you, there's no one around. And I'm like, where in the world were the security guards or anyone? Yeah, nothing.
All right, well, we're gonna see if we can find out a bit more about this for sure. Thank you for calling us and alerting us at any rate about this. This is very, very serious.
I have to tell you, all I'm saying is that I just really hope that anyone who is in Caranha Bay right now, I'm like, just be leery of this guy, because they still have not caught him, and I'm supposed to talk to the police at 10 o'clock this morning, and I'm telling you, I don't know where he is, but he's still out there. He's still out there. So.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you for letting us know. I mean, you know, like I said, we'll try to confirm some of the facts, but we all have to be vigilant. So we appreciate you bringing this to our attention so that we can definitely be on the lookout.
Yeah. Yeah,
pretty crazy. All right, Tracy, try not to stress yourself out too much. And do let me know how the interview goes with the police as well.
Okay, I will.
All right, thanks very much.
All right, lovely. Okay,
bye. All right, my dear, bye. Okay. Yeah, this is pretty, this is a wild story. We got to get to the bottom of this one for sure. I'm putting on my detective hat right now. Y'all know how this goes. Sandy's on the case. We got to figure out what's going on. Wow. I don't know what to make of this one. Yeah, Venetia says she's probably afraid to leave her house now. You can hear that in her voice. This was very traumatic. Listen, any sort of event that's unexpected, any sort of assault, definitely can leave you in a state of disbelief, shock, and traumatized. So Darlene says he's cooling off. His match will soon get him. Well, hopefully, again, we can figure out who this person is. She said that she's seen footage from Caymana Bay. We have reached out to them already on WhatsApp to inquire, you know, what they have to say about this incident. And as soon as we have some additional details, I'll certainly let you guys know. Because, yeah, we need to get a photo, a video, something to get this guy off the streets ASAP. Wow, this is pretty crazy. Unbelievable, really. But we'll see what we can do. Oh, my gosh. I'm shocked, and I'm just listening to the story. All right, we do have some guests who are joining us on the show this morning. And then we've got a segment of Cayman Voices that's coming up as well. I'm getting a flood of messages in my WhatsApp. And obviously, all of you here on the show are very, very concerned. Yeah, Michael, she kept saying 10 o'clock this afternoon. I mean, she sounded a little bit confused about the time. But again, that could be stress. So Blackberry says, poor thing, she's still in shock. I pray that they find the nastiness and prosecute him fully. So, yes. Kathy says, I sure hope she sobers up before giving a police statement and gets her facts straight. From this interview, she's looking at dismal in court. Oh, my goodness. So she said that this happened around 1:30 in the afternoon. Like, this is broad daylight. And I do find it, I mean, Caymana Bay is always bustling with people. Like, occasionally, I go there. The other day, I went there in the middle of the afternoon. It was probably like maybe 2 o'clock or maybe after 3. And I needed to get some work done on the laptop. And I sat right there in front of Haagen-Dazs, the little chairs there, to get some work done so that I could, you know, just take a minute, jump on the laptop and stuff. And I mean, there are people coming and going. I mean, there are like thousands of people that work in Caymana Bay. There's a grocery store that's right there. That's always a very packed parking lot. You know, parents taking kids to and from different things. So I would find it hard to believe that nobody saw anything. So if you did see something and you're listening to this, maybe she didn't see you, because sometimes when we're in a situation, we don't necessarily see other people. So it's entirely possible that maybe she didn't see you all, but you all saw something going on. Please come forward, speak to the security individuals at Caymana Bay. They do have their own security detail, but I do know that things like this, they obviously hand over to the police when there's an actual crime that is committed, yeah? And to be very, very clear, I don't know who was telling her a crime hasn't been committed, but any form of unwanted touching. Let me just break it down for you, because I think there's a lot of people who are confused about what equates to assault. Even with the Makiva Bush case, we know a lot of people are confused after that. But any unwanted touching, right? So you can even just poke somebody with one single finger, and that's an offense. That's common assault. You can flip somebody's hat with your finger. Don't even directly touch them. That is common assault, right? If you get in their face and your spit touches their face, that's common assault. So I can't imagine that somebody who has grabbed you, grabbed your purse, stolen your purse, and grabbed you in any sort of a private part, you know, that's indecent assault on top of everything else. So yeah, that would definitely be an offense, plus the theft of the handbag. So I would say at least three offenses right there have been committed. Common assault, theft of the handbag, and indecent assault if he actually groped her as well. So if a police officer told her that, they may need some retraining. Michael says, maybe I look shady or something, because when I go to Kimana Bay, it always seems like I have security looking at me. Oh my gosh. KK says, yes, that's a crime. Taking her purse, touching her without permission, that's a crime. Absolutely. Absolutely. And I would say without fear of any contradiction that Kimana Bay in particular would take this very, very seriously. And she's saying that she's seen the footage. So this should be a very open and shut case if they have all that in footage. They just have to find the guy. All right, so let's pause that discussion and let's invite our friends from somebody else that says using force or fear in a robbery as well. That's causing fear. What's the exact offense called? Causing fear or provocation, making threats. Like that's a whole separate offense as well. So that is true. If he said anything to her or his actions amounted to that as well, that's entirely a different offense. So I will definitely keep you guys updated. But it's important if something happens. Again, you know, we talk a lot in this program about the need for women in particular, but men and women, to always be vigilant and to protect yourself. And, you know, even mere words can amount to assault. You know, there's an assault and battery. The words can be a form of assault as well. So, you know, you don't have to put up with that kind of bad behavior no matter who you are or where you are. And I was a bit concerned when she first called in and said, you know, she's not going to get justice because she's an expat. That's ridiculous. Everybody is entitled to the same justice. This is in theory, because after a guest, we're going to talk about this gun case. And I do question how the law is applied. But in theory, every victim is entitled to the same rights as any other victim. And every perpetrator, you know, should be treated pretty much the same. There are things that come into play, like previous records and that sort of thing, that will make your sentencing a little bit more individualized. Somebody said this is where the pepper spray would come in handy in this situation. I don't even think so, because quite honestly, if he grabbed her from behind, when would she have had time to get pepper spray? The pepper spray would have probably been in the handbag. So, you know, I don't know. All right, folks. Taste the K-Man. Let's talk about something a little bit happier. Taste the K-Man. Mr. J.A. Hart, good morning.
Good morning. Is it happy? Is Taste the K-Man happy? Yes, of course it is.
Yes.
Is there good drink, good music? Of course it's happy.
I know. Uh-oh. Looks like they sent me an overlay that doesn't work. It hides everything. Hold on now. Oh, gosh. We can't use that one because that's hiding everybody. Oh, my goodness. Okay. I know. Let me just send this across. Maybe they can shoot me another one real quick. Maureen is also in the house.
Hello. Hi, guys. How's it going? Morning.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Fantastic. Fantastic.
Can't believe it's been a year since we've all done this. This is a bit, wow, that came by.
I flew by really fast, I must admit.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I'm happy to have you back because we got a lot to talk about this morning.
I never get to see Dr. Maureen, by the way.
I know. I don't get to see all you all. But, and I'm a little jealous. I don't have an overlay. Like, I feel like next time.
Oh. Yeah.
Fun something. Anyway, next time I'll work on it.
Yes, that's okay. So listen, the taste is back in full swing, 1 week out.
Yeah,
so we have a lot tonight to talk about, Jay. Wow, tell us, let's start off with Friday, because we know that this year, this is a very unique year, in that you actually have a two-day event. So it's like a whole weekend pass, a whole weekend event. So we've got the big concert that's happening on the Friday, and that's Black Eyed Peas. And in case anybody missed it, let me just show this to them real quick.
Taste of Cayman is back with a side of Black Eyed Peas. Friday, April 12th. The Food and Drink Festival on April 13th. Bundle tickets and save. Don't miss out on the culinary and chef demos. Delicious food and drink from over 25 vendors. Caymanian cultural performances. Live music, mixology, and more. Taste of Cayman is presented by DART with the support of many valued sponsors. Buy your tickets at tasteofcayman.org.
All right. So Black Eyed Peas.
Black Eyed Peas, Friday night. It is. I've been dealing a lot with these guys, and they're really super wonderful people.
Yeah.
But this is going to be a show like a show you would see in Miami or New York or whatever. All the backstage stuff is going to happen. Pyrotechnics, mm-hmm. lasers. Everything is going to happen. It is going to be just like a show you see anywhere else. It's not a scaled down version. They're going all out for the people of the Cayman Islands. And I'm really, really impressed with what they got planned for us. So it's going to be exciting. But before that, we got Dan Ebanks opening up for them. And then the Neverines. And then DJ RKM is going to be playing right before Black Eyed Peas play for a good 90 minutes. So it is going to be very exciting. And all that's right, all Friday night.
Full concert on the Friday night. Tell us what tickets are still available, because I know that tickets were...
No, VIP is almost sold out. I mean, like this close. We've got just a few VIP left. So if you're interested in that, please buy those today. We do have lots of premium view left and general admission. So,
all right, and tell us the difference now. People are listening. They're trying to decide which ticket they want. So what's the difference between VIP and then the premium view?
VIP will have their own bar inside the air-conditioned tent. They're going to have premium viewing. You're going to be literally right in front of the stage. And there's going to be a separate bar, separate bathrooms, everything. It's a nicer experience. And we're purposely not just selling a ton of VIP tickets because we want this to be a special event. We want you to feel special in VIP. You know, you go to some VIP things and there's like 1,000 people and then you're like,
right.
You feel you're very VIP. We're definitely going to make you feel VIP in this. So we really wanted to cap it and make sure that only a few people get in. Well, not a few, but you know, a short number of people get in there. Mm-hmm. So that's going to be the main stage right in front and stage right. Premium view is going to be right behind that, but still center stage. So you're going to be right there, center stage, with your own access to the main bar. You'll have one side of the main bar just for you as part of premium viewing. And the general admission is everywhere else. So general admission does not have, unless you're behind the bar, straight on access view of the main stage. You're going to be a little stage right, or you're going to be a little stage left, or a little further back. Mm-hmm. But still, being in the back a little bit here with only 5,000 people, instead of being in the nosebleeds of a concert in Miami up in the top of a stadium, you're still going to have a great view of the band playing, and you're going to be there with 5,000 of your closest friends.
Mm-hmm. nice, wonderful. All right, so VIP options still available, but there's opportunity is going to be closing here shortly.
Yeah, there's dozens left. That's all. There's not much left.
Yeah,
I just got a WhatsApp just now. Like, I want to buy six. I'm like, do it now. I can't help you.
All right. So where tell people where to get their tickets from.
Tasteofcayman.org is your best spot to go. It's got all the answers for everything. Everything we're talking about here today is on tasteofcayman.org, and it allows you to buy the tickets as well. Mm-hmm. So it talks about what Maureen's going to be doing on our demo stage. It talks about the visiting chefs we're bringing. It has the lineup for Friday and Saturday night. It talks about all of the restaurants that are taking part on Saturday night, all of the food vendors that are there Friday night. et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So tasteofcayman.org.
All right. So folks, get your tickets now. Time's running out. We're basically a week out.
Cayman's a last minute place. Everybody's going to buy them last minute, but we don't want you to do that. We don't want you to miss out on VIP.
Yeah.
If you want a VIP experience, you want to buy these tickets.
Yep. Absolutely. All right. So, and then the Saturday we're going to bring in Maureen here because she has got lots of stuff, arranged. Now, first of all, we have finally, we can reveal who the celebrity chefs are. So should we do a little drum roll, please? And tell us about the celebrity chefs and what they're going
to
be.
Do I get to do that?
Sure, Maureen, why don't you do that for me?
Are you sure?
Yeah. Do you have it there?
Yeah, of course I have it there. I know who these people are. Come on. That's
they're actually pretty famous. I'm pretty impressed for bringing them down.
Yeah, no, it's really cool.
If you're a foodie, you know who these people are.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I did. So, you know, it's one of the main guests that are coming down is someone who is definitely world renowned in sort of the bakery and confectionery world. And his name is Ron Ben Israel. And anyone who is in that industry or knows it, he is world famous for his amazing, like beautiful tower cakes and confections. He's got a beautiful studio in Soho in Manhattan. And he's just well sought after all over the world. So he's also been a host for Sweet Genius. So anyone who watches who's a junkie for any of the Food Network shows, when it comes around those weeks, he's going to judge with, Cupcake Wars, Chopped, Guy's Grocery Game. So yeah, just an amazing guy. And when I saw this, I was like, wow, that's pretty big. That's pretty big that we've got him here. So he's one of our guests. And then we also have Chef Mark Straussman. So Chef Mark Straussman is a Michelin trained chef. He actually, you know, Barney's New York, right? Like the iconic Barney's New York, Fifth Madison. He created the restaurant that's inside of that and the culinary concept inside of that called Fred's. So was there for years and years, and then now has his own place called Mark's Off Fifth. And it's French, Italian, but definitely focused on sort of that New York's comfort food vibe also. So that's pretty exciting to have both of them here. And we've got lots of things planned with them for the weekend. So I'm excited to meet them and work with them and do a few different things. So those are our celeb chefs that are in Cayman for Taste of Cayman.
And I want to show our listeners some of the work for these. I mean, they're artists. Trust me, when I see cakes, I'm like, whoa, this is pretty cool. Let me just show, check this out. These are some of his cakes. Like, wow, what on earth?
I know.
It's amazing.
I mean, like this is not my world. So just to see this and just kind of understanding what he does and getting to know a little bit more about him in this process. I'm like, wow, it's pretty remarkable.
Yeah. Ron Ben Israel, chef and owner of one of the world's most established couture cake studios. Collections of trend-setting cakes has been spotted all over the world, top-end hotels in New York, for example, and different venues featured in countless publications and TV shows, including The New York Times, Vogue Magazine, Oprah Winfrey Show, The Late Show, and The David Letterman Show, and many, many more. I mean, it's just phenomenal when I look at his cakes and, you know, he's done a lot of work for celebrities in terms of like weddings and special events. Here, I'm going to show you guys this chocolate one because it's just amazing.
Ooh,
you almost don't want to eat these cakes when you see them. I know.
They're literally sought all over the world.
Yeah.
You know, like people will order them and somehow get them, or if you're having any sort of special, look at that, it's amazing, it's just beyond
so pretty. Oh my gosh, absolutely gorgeous. Look at that.
Wow,
looks delicious.
I know.
And I'm sure everything on there is edible, all the flowers, like everything.
That's actually one of his specialties is the artistry around making these beautiful flowers. So he works with sugar, fondant, and all of these amazing ingredients and that carves these and teaches people how to do them in his culinary studio. It's remarkable. So super exciting to have someone of that caliber here in Cayman.
Now, can we expect that he's going to, exactly what will he do I'm
now
here.
You know I can't tell you that, Sandy. Come on, girl.
I could finagle it out of you.
Oh, come on. Well, okay. I can tell you this. I can tell you that it's going to be it's going to be really lovely and extra special for people mm-hmm. who are going to engage in it. That's all I can say.
But we can tell you that they are going to be at our Sunday brunch that we're adding yes. to the lineup.
There you go. Okay.
So it's going to be a fun, relaxed family-style brunch at Saltwater Grill. And mm-hmm. those chefs, Ron Ben Israel and Mark Strassman, are going to be helping and working alongside the Saltwater Grill chefs to create these signature dishes. And yeah. I guarantee, well, I can't guarantee, but I'm pretty sure we're going to have a nice cake.
yeah.
And the tickets are available via saltwaterkman.com. Go there for the tickets. Contact Saltwater for the all-inclusive family-style brunch.
Mm-hmm.
Lovely.
Nice. All right. So, of course, not to be outdone by the cake man, we also have Mark Strassman, and he's a Michelin-trained restaurant chef, restaurateur, and author who's achieved the coveted position of chef de partie.
Yeah, you said it, chef de partie. You got it.
I've never taken French, so I'm always like, oh God, that sounds horrible. All right.
Nope, you did it.
So a senior chef in the mid-1980s, he's chef and owner of the critically acclaimed Mark's off Madison restaurant and bakery in New York City. So let's show you some of his stuff. Oh, his stuff just looks like, oh my God, when you want good food, good soups, good everything.
Yeah.
He seems like he's the one who's going to just make my belly happy.
Yeah, he's the guy. I've eaten there. So, and it's just delicious. I mean, the bagels that he makes is beyond. I mean, New York is known for bagels, right? I mean, mm-hmm. his bagels makes his own beautiful cream cheeses. He's got like all these great, like, I mean, he's Italian and French trained. So, mm-hmm. So the matzo ball soup. But you know, he's definitely, you can see all of those.
Hey, there's him with bagels. Yummy.
Oh my gosh. Honestly, they're so good. So again, like really great to have someone of this caliber that mm-hmm. not only understands, you know, the culinary part of things, but you right. know, you can see that he's got this great training, but at the same time is very down to earth and is very interested in sort of that comfort food and making food approachable and easy for people. And I think that's, I mean, one of the many reasons why he's successful. So
absolutely. Oh my yeah, God.
I know.
I'm a bit hungry this morning.
I was just going to be like, I'd like that, please.
Yes. So again, he's also been featured in tons of magazines and TV shows, NBC's The Today Show, CBS This Morning, Martha Stewart Living, and many, many more. Mm-mm-mm. So I gotta go next time I go to New York. I gotta check out this Mark's off Madison. Is it something yeah. that I gotta make reservations like a month in advance or?
No. I mean, I think he does get busy. I happened to go there a few years ago, and it was a bit of a lineup, but mm-hmm. I just pushed my way through. No, I'm just joking. I didn't do that at all. Come
like, let me in. I'm here.
Come on, I'm from Cayman. I need a bagel.
Yeah.
It's lovely. And you can, like I said, it's going to be a really, really nice addition to what we're going to be doing on the Bombay Bar.
Oh my gosh.
Seriously, this is torture. Jeez Louise. My God.
I know. Trust me. I'm feeling it. Mm-mm-mm.
Dang.
Look at those yum. Prongs.
I know.
Oh my God. Everything on here, I'm like, I'll take a little bit of this and a little bit of that.
Yeah. That's a great shot right
Sunday
there.
Brunch, it'll have all of that.
Yeah.
So I'm very, very interested. I'm glad you mentioned the Sunday brunch, Jay, because I'm totally interested in that. So I better get my tickets for that. All right. So let's go through the details so that everybody knows how to get tickets, what time or, you know, the show starts for Saturday as well. So folks, for the first time ever, Taste of Cayman really is a weekend long, now that we know about the brunch, this entire weekend long event, and really, really expanding their reach in culinary food and drinks, beverages. So celebrity chefs have been announced. You're hearing it right here on The Cold Hard Truth. And then for the chef's itinerary, I want to make sure that if you want to see them working, you got to get there, right? So Saturday, April the 13th, There'll be culinary demos at the Bon Voyant demo stage. So you can go there and watch and see all the wonderful stuff. Do you get to taste anything from the demo stage?
Well, it depends on the demo, right? So yeah. Yes-ish. And that's the most terrible answer in the world, but yes-ish. So the run of the show is very typical to what it's been traditionally, but we've got a few surprises this year. So it does start at 5:30. Okay. We always open with the kids session. That's mm-hmm. always popular. If you've got mm-hmm. little ones that are going to be there and are interested in just coming and saying hi to us and all that, please bring them. There is an opportunity for them to come up on stage. This year, our demo is going to be extra special. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. limiting the space is there. So please make sure if your little ones are interested in anything like that, come up and be there for right. We want to start right at 5:30. So bring mm-hmm. them right up. And then we roll into another demo with our chefs. And then we will talk a little bit about the winners from the Cayman style beef and heavy cake competition, which always drums up some local excitement and people rolling up their sleeves and getting excited about that. So we'll announce that.
Did you put your heavy cake in?
No, yeah, okay. I haven't. I'm thinking about it.
People were saying this last year to me. They were saying this to me last year. They were like, oh man, I should have entered. It's like, enter. It's super fun and it's great. Yeah. And it's just it's just a cool thing. It's all in the, like, everything came out.
Bragging rights and stuff. Not that I need bragging rights, but you know.
It's totally, totally good. So yeah. I would say definitely enter. Anyone who's ever been interested in entering something like this, do it. It's fun and it's just something to be a part of. And then also we have a small cook-off. So Mark mm-hmm. is going to be doing a little comfort food cook-off with one of our okay. local chefs. And then we will have some of our culinary students going to be joining us also. And then we go right into the mixology competition, which is the offshore gin mixology competition. So nice, well-rounded. We'll be having lots of fun. Come and see me. Come and see everyone. Come meet everyone. And we're very much looking forward to having a fun time on that stage.
Mm-hmm. All right. So that, folks, is the Bon Voyant demo stage activities. Lots of stuff going on there. And then we've got, in general now, Jay, tell us about what people can expect from the event this year. Over 30 restaurants and vendor booths. Wow.
Yeah, it's huge. We've got a lot more. This is, I believe, the team told me yesterday, mm-hmm. it's the most food and beverage vendors we've had ever at a Tasty Cayman. So that's mm-hmm. great. Mm-hmm. Hopefully the lines won't be too long, but all your favorites are going to be there, yeah. like Sambuco, Chicken, Island Tastes, Vivo, Agave, Penne Pasta, Steak Social, City Walk Restaurant, and some you might not have ever heard of before, and some brand new ones like Aria and Alora are going to be there as well. Mm-hmm. And that's the great thing is, if you might not have heard it, say you live in Prospect or Savannah, and you go to Alora and Aria all the time, but you might not all get over to Vivo over in West Bay. So it's a good chance for you to try some of these fantastic restaurants that aren't on your normal list of places you go to. So the food's going to be delicious. We've got food trucks there as well. Burger Shack, Murph's Kitchen, Ala Kebab, all the great stuff. Fantastic drink vendors. Haagen-Dazs is going to have an alcoholic ice cream as well. We're going to have non-alcoholic ice cream for the kids as well. Mm-hmm. Plenty of great drinks. And I'm very excited. It's going to be mm-hmm. a very fun Saturday afternoon. And then, of course, when all that's over, because we've got the All Things Cayman stage mm-hmm. as well, where all those, we've got crab races. We're going to have soldier crab races. We're going to have conch blowing, batch making, all of the stuff, demonstrations there. And then we really kick it off with the true Caymanian entertainment of Swanky Kitchen Band. And that has gotten me very excited. I love those guys. Every time I hear him, it puts a smile on my face. And I do a little dance, even though I dance poorly. I still have a little dance.
Look forward to seeing that. That's good.
Yeah. And what time for Saturday, what time do gates open?
Gates open at 5 on Saturday. On Friday, gates open at 7.
Okay.
Music starts at 8 on Friday. Mm-hmm. And then music starts at 7:30 on Saturday. But you want to go there early, bring the kids, bring the family, have some food, relax, enjoy. Then you can go take the kids home and come back for a dance party. We still have more music after that. We've got a DJ. We'll have mm-hmm. fireworks around 9:15. Then Rico Rolando is going to be on the stage later in the evening. And then we've got a great DJ rounding out the end of the night. And I think They're going to be playing some very fun stuff to dance to and enjoy. It's going to be great.
Beautiful. And you can still get tickets, folks. Again, buy your tickets, tasteofcayman.org. That's the online option. And there's a number of retail outlets as well for purchasing your tickets. So lots of Office Supply, Sports and Diver Supply, Funky Tangs, Blackbeards. They've got multiple locations. Grand Harbor, Eastern Avenue, Excuse, Caymana Bay, Tower Marketing, their office there in the Fidelity Financial Building. And there are actually going to be some pop-up sales booths as well.
Yep, so we're going to be at Hurley's today.
Today at Foster's Caymana Bay from 11 a.m. until 2 p.m.
Yep.
You can go by there and grab your tickets. And then Hurley's also today from 2:30 until 4 p.m. And then Monday, coming up on Monday, where's the one on Monday? It says 3 to 5.
It looks like it's at the Westin. So we're going to try and hit up some of the tourists that are going to be here on island. And but that's another great thing is we know we're going to get a ton of tourists going to this, because if you come to the Cayman Islands for the weekend, next weekend, and you hear Black Eyed Peas are playing, you're going to go.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But we urge you to buy your tickets now. Just get in there. You don't want to miss out on VIP if that's the way you want to go.
Yeah.
But if you want to go to both days, go to tasteofcayman.org. You can bundle your passes together and you save 10%. So it's a really good deal right now. So it's tasteofcayman.org. Please go there now.
Beautiful. All right. So let's talk about some of your sponsors who have made all of this possible.
Yeah, we couldn't do without, it's all presented by DART, Kempa Home, FYI, AI Rentals, the team at DMS Broadcasting, Bobo, Visit Cayman Islands, Forza, you guys at Cayman Mall Road, if you're fantastic, Hughes, the Kempton Sea Fire Resort, St. June at the Ritz-Carlton is going to be providing canopies at the VIP area, CJ Pritkay, the Ministry of Youth, Sports, and Heritage, Tower Marketing, and I believe we're going to add the Ministry of Tourism to that list very soon.
Nice.
So I'll give a shout out. I love the ministry.
Yes, absolutely. All right, good stuff. So, of course, you know, we love to give away stuff here, especially on a Friday. Why not? So, listen up, Katie.
Do I get dinner with Maureen?
That's just anytime.
I got to
make sure. And if you don't mind, Sandy, I'm just going to give Bombi Vont a shout out too, because they're a lot on the stage and doing all our good stuff with us. So
somebody's calling already. Hello, caller.
Oh, yes, I want to win.
But you don't know the question yet.
I can give it right now.
Okay, let's see.
The volunteers are great. Thank you, Starman.
They call in before the question. All right. Well, let me tell you what is up for grabs. We have two premium stage view tickets for Friday. The question is, drum roll, what is the Peas? So the Black Eyed Peas, what is the Peas member's name who is from the Philippines?
The Black Eyed Peas member from the Philippines.
You're trying to get
a friend.
This isn't call a friend. You got good morning, caller.
Good morning.
Do you know the answer?
Yes, I'm a Filipino. It's apples.
Congratulations. This isn't dial a friend. I mean. I'm not sure what that was, but yeah.
That was cute. That was question, cute.
And then you also need to dial a friend. Oh, come on now. Well, congratulations. You just won yourself two amazing, you know, tickets. And by the way, remind me the value of these tickets. Aren't they like $300 each?
They are, yes.
This is fantastic. Wow. Two premium stage VIP. That's total winnings there of $600. Who are you going to take with you? You got a special friend you're taking?
Yes, I'm going to take my husband to be.
Yay, there you go. Fantastic. Date night. Yes. All right, can we just get a first name? We'll pass that along.
Okay, do I give you my first name right now?
Yes, or you can WhatsApp it to me if you want.
Oh, well, my name is Anne, so everybody knows.
Okay.
Hi, Anne.
All right. Congratulations, Anne. Fantastic.
Thank you.
You are so welcome. Have a good day.
You too. Bye-bye.
So next Friday, she's going to be getting ready. Yeah. Wow. That's great. Love it.
Chantel? Right, well,
I saw a question there about who the celebrity chefs were again.
Oh, yeah. Chantel, you missed that. Let's go over that again.
So it is Ron Ben Israel, who is a world-renowned pastry chef and baker, and also Mark Straussman, who is a Michelin-trained chef and owns Mark's off Madison in New York.
Nice.
Both of them been featured throughout Food Network and Oprah, Martha Stewart, all that good stuff. So yeah, very, very excited to have them here.
Yeah, both phenomenal options. Perla is asking, she says, I love Taste the Cayman. Do you accept community points for the teens to come and help them out? They would love to help. I don't know what community points are, but yeah, I'm sure.
Yep. tasteofcayman.org/volunteers or how can you get involved, link, and volunteer. We'd love to have you. And someone else also mentioned, I couldn't do this without our volunteers. We literally have like 150 volunteers that help us out for the whole weekend. And they're amazing. And the team of Tower Marketing is burning the midnight oil. I left my office at about 8 o'clock last night, and they still had the car park was full at their office. They are really doing a great job for us. So I can't say enough wonderful things about the team Tower.
Wow. Fantastic. Yeah. I don't think, you know, once they're in full swing with all things Taste the Cayman, all other projects are put on hold because, you know, it's all hands on deck. I mean, I know this because they're constantly sending out stuff to the media. And of course, CMR is on board, happy to be for a second year as an exclusive, you know, at least print media. We don't technically print, but you guys know what I mean. Online media sponsor. So we're happy to tell you guys that this is going to be another fantastic event. Ironing out some of the little kinks that existed last year, and hopefully it's going to be really, really smooth. We'll do a walkthrough. I think that I'll schedule that with Charisse probably like the Friday. So I want everybody to keep an eye on that. We're going to send out the map here in short order so that you can see where everything is going to be situated. And then, we'll do a walkthrough to kind of give you a feel, a lay of the land, so to speak. But be comfortable, have good walking shoes. I know some of y'all want to go fancy with high heels. I saw a few, I think they might've been the beauty queens though. So they always got to be fancy. But the thing to do is take some comfortable walking shoes. Probably closed toed kind of works better. Be comfortable. Wear your pants or skirt that has a lot of room, you know, the elastic waist.
That's a given.
You stop at a few boots and all of a sudden you're like, oh my God, I got to sit down. Take your Pepto-Bismol if you need it.
Oh no, nobody's going to need that.
that might help you make room on the other side. Anyway, folks, this is absolutely a fantastic event. How many years now, Jay?
36.
Wow. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, it's great. And I've been to pretty much almost all of them. Yeah. I've been to at least 25, so that's not too bad.
Wow. For me, 23 for me, so
Nice. Oof. Beautiful. All right. So that's Maureen and Jay joining us this morning. Taste the Cayman next weekend. Listen, do not delay. Get your tickets today. They're going to have Foster's, Kamana Bay, Hurley's, and then on Monday, the tourists can grab some tickets as well. So go online, tasteofcayman.org is another option for you, or just contact Tower Marketing. They're there, and they can give you some tickets as well. Thanks a lot, guys.
No, we're excited, and thank you, Sandy. Appreciate it.
Yes, absolutely. Really appreciate it.
And thank you, Maureen. You're a great volunteer as well. Thank you.
My pleasure. It's my jam. I enjoy it very much. So thanks for having me. And I hope that I see Gigi.
Yeah, she'll be there. Last year we didn't have time for the kids section, but she had a great time. But we'll try to come out a little bit earlier this time as well.
Yeah, I'd like to see her. It's been a while, so that'd be great. Thank you. All right. Take care. See you guys. Have a great
Taste of Cayman is back with a side of black eyed peas. Friday, April 12th, the Food and Drink Festival on April 13th. Bundle tickets and save. Don't miss out on the culinary and chef demos. Delicious food and drink from over 25 vendors. Caymanian cultural performances. Live music, mixology, and more. Taste of Cayman is presented by DART with the support of many valued sponsors. Buy your tickets at tasteofcayman.org.
Do you own a 1996 to 2016 Honda vehicle? There is an ongoing urgent safety recall regarding faulty Takata airbag inflators in Honda vehicles in the Cayman Islands. As affected vehicles get older, a combination of high temperatures and humidity can affect airbag inflators with the fault. If you're involved in a collision, the airbag can go off with too much explosive force, causing sharp metal fragments to shoot out and kill or seriously injure people in the vehicle. To check whether your vehicle is affected, go to HondaCayman.com/recalls. Honda will replace any defective airbag inflators completely free of charge. Contact the Car City service team to arrange this. Please take the time to check if your vehicle is affected by this urgent safety recall by going to HondaCayman.com/recalls now.
All right, folks, some really important messaging there for you. Everybody, it is Friday. Good morning. How are you guys doing, honey chill? So we got some great stuff coming up here for you, including a premiere of another episode of Cayman Voices. This one you guys are going to love, honey chill. It's Andy Martin. Oh, yeah. Cayman Cowboy. Mm-hmm. Had an opportunity to sit down with him. And we had a beautiful chat. Oh my gosh. I listen, sometimes even when the cameras are turned off, we're still chatting. Really, really interesting guy. And I was pleased to have had the opportunity to interview him. And I got other people coming up on my list. So if you get a call from me, if you're a family member of someone 60 and over and you want to have them featured in Cayman Voices, please call me. Y'all know my number, honey chia. That's it's no state secret. 324-1612 is my personal number. Show line 936-2626. And I'm not like those politicians who change their numbers. You know, when they get in, the number becomes scarce. They change it or they hand it to somebody else. And then you're like, I can't reach them no more. Well, you can call me, honey chia. You call me. So, trying to get as many people as possible to, you know, build the archives, if you will, for Cayman Voices. And you know what is so beautiful about this is in the moment, people don't realize what it is that I'm capturing until we get to the point where, you know, you see it and then family members are like, oh my God, Sandy, can we get a copy of this for our family? And I'm like, absolutely. Of course. This is a community project brought to you proudly sponsored by the DART organization. So big little shameless plug and shout out to them. Rough Seas, was that you saying that you're not getting married anymore? So you don't want to look at any expensive cakes? Oh my God, Rough Seas, you crack me up. You crack me up. My goodness. Listen, weddings are not the only reason that you might need a cake. I'm just saying, you can order cake for all sorts of parties. All right. Congratulations again to Anne. She's a listener to the program. She's what's up. She's like, it's me. I'm the winner. I was like, oh, hey, congrats. Wow. That's awesome. Okay. All right. So we were talking about the situation that came out of Bay. I'm still waiting for some additional details. The story is a little bit confusing. And I don't know if that's because, you know, she is traumatized. I mean, certainly I think any sort of experience like that would be shocking and traumatizing, or if there's anything else that's going on. So I don't know. I don't know. That's why we gotta flush it out. Like I said, we're going to put on our detective hats and figure out what's really going on here. The good thing about Cayman Bay is they've got cameras everywhere, like literally cameras everywhere. So they have a whole security center and they got a whole, it's manned by their security detail. And you know, everything is being recorded. So if something happens there, you can better believe that they got it on camera, honey chill. Big shout out, hold on now. Hold on. We're going to do a little something here. Hold on. One second. Let me look up a phone number. We're going to call somebody. Everybody in Cayman's like, don't call me. I don't know what this is about. If your phone is going to ring now, just answer it. I know y'all be scared. this between 7:30 and 10:30. Everybody's like, do not answer your phone. If it's Sandy, don't answer. But today you want to answer your phone. Answer the phone. Mm-hmm. Dun, dun, dun. This is a surprise.
You called me.
Hello, birthday boy.
Hi.
Happy birthday. How you doing, honey child?
Right here, Miss Bradley.
Nice. Well, happy birthday. How old you is now? 2, 5, 10? I'm just 24. Trying to guess. 24. All right, we'll go with 24. Well, we wanted to wish you a happy birthday. Obviously, you are a fan of the show, an avid listener. This is Leroy, in case anybody's listening going, who the heck did she just call? This is Leroy. So, Leroy, we're wishing you an absolutely fantastic and happy birthday.
Thank you.
All right, you're most welcome. And I got a little something for you this weekend. I'll link you. I'll message you. Get a little birthday all gift right. from the CMR crew.
All right,
good stuff. Yes, Leroy. He said he'll stick with 25. All right, that'll work. Yes, wish Leroy happy birthday, folks. He's here every single day. One of our good students. At least he shows up. We're going to be talking about today. Isn't the day for it because we got to do a deep dive into this recent report, which basically is talking about how dismal the public education system is. My God, whoa. I knew it was bad, but honestly, I didn't know it was that bad. Every parent, and I don't care whether your child goes to public school, private school, I don't care. If you don't even have kids in school anymore, everyone in this community, or you don't even have kids, everybody in this community should be very, very concerned by how we, the adults, appear to be failing our children, and they, in turn, are failing. This is a serious indictment on the entire country. It is also an indictment on the ministry, on the department, on the minister. Everybody has to take some blame in this. The teachers. So I'm hoping that, because I need to collate some information. I got my team of one. I told her I'm going to call her my super sleuth analyst. She's going to get some information for me, because the reality is, for what we're paying, we shouldn't have these kind of results. And that is the bottom line. We're spending tons of money on education, and the results that we are reaping is something wrong. Something is wrong. Somebody just said parents need to demand more from education. You better believe that. And we're going to start making those demands next week. Going to collate some facts for you. Because you gotta be in the right frame of mind to address this issue, and you gotta make sure you got all your stats and everything to have a proper discussion. Anybody wants to join me in the show? I'd love to hear from educators. You teachers now getting $5,000 a month, because apparently Ms. Julie's philosophy with everything is just throw money at it. That solves all problems. Clearly, it doesn't. That's a problem. We can dissect it. Do a deep dive next week. I'm hoping that by probably Tuesday or Wednesday's program, we're going to be peeling off the layers of this problem, because this is shocking and horrendous. All right. Good morning, Stephanie. Damien is in the house. Miss Olive is here. Says, happy birthday, Leroy. I pray you day on many more. I don't know what that's just mean. To come, that you have many more to come, I guess. Be blessed and productive and more life and more blessing. Dean doing some birthday shout outs to Leroy as well. Says, wish you lots more happy, healthy and happy years. Marcia says, happy birthday, Leroy. Enjoy your day. Strong will. Good morning. Siobhan says, where was my birthday call and stuff? I see. You gotta remind me is a problem. So when I saw what's his name, bad student Johan jump in and wishing him a happy birthday, I was like, oh yes, he did say that today's his birthday. So really, it was Johan that remembered. I guess he gets a little, not a full pass, but a little extra check mark next to his name. Jeffrey says, happy birthday, Leroy. Miss Jean says, hey, happy birthday, neighbor. Very, very nice. Just me, says Miss Sandy. I'm not doubting that she isn't traumatized and that this event didn't happen to her. And good that they have footage, just for an FYI. But sometimes the kind of drugs you take have you creating thoughts. Okay. Gail, I mean, Jerry, sorry, good morning. Says they're getting well to don't care. You mean they're getting paid well to don't care. So blessed that I could afford to put my child in a private school. This is sad. Girl, let me tell you something, Jerry. Like I keep saying, I told my husband, if we got a twerk and a pole, and I'm not the twerking on the pole kind of person, but that's, I might have to compromise myself. Because that's how important a good education. You make whatever sacrifices you have to make for your kids. And getting them a good foundation in life, there's nothing more important than that. You know, parents got a part in this too. Don't y'all think that y'all can sit back and, oh, we're going to just blame education. Y'all got to do better. This is a collective effort. And so we're going to attack this from all angles next week. Paul says that he's going to sit in the back of the classroom. No problem, Paul. Wee-wee, good morning to Robert. Not Robert, it's Robert. He says, good morning, superstar. Hello, darling. How are you? Marshall, wishing Leroy a happy birthday. Chris K says, I barely go to Camana Bay, but my last two visits, both Saturdays, the place was like a ghost town. I didn't spot any security guard around either. Really? Where in Camana Bay were you? I mean, the one by the crosswalk, he's always there. And there's normally one hanging out, like, right in front of Haagen-Dazs, probably 90% of the time. I do frequent Camana Bay because, you know, there's a lot of good restaurants in there and stuff. In fact, I was there on Friday last week. And I checked out the new Mexican restaurant. Big shout out to them. Because you guys know I love me some Mexican corn and everything. So I tried that out. It was good. So, I mean, I don't know about a Saturday, but I can tell you Friday was bustling. Like, it was busy. That restaurant was packed. Everywhere was packed. So I find it hard to believe that you could be walking around Camana Bay and it's a ghost town. I mean, I'm not saying, Chris, that it wasn't when you were there. I'm just saying I have never seen a ghost town, especially on a weekend. People are going and coming from the cinema. They've got ice cream time. You got people playing in the, taking the kids to play in the little water fountains. So I don't know what's going on. Johan Moxon says that's got to be a superstar, super strong pole if you're working it. Johan, there's some things I could say to you right now, but I'm going to be good. I'm going to be good because one of us has to be the adult around here, and it's clearly not you. Oh, my gosh. Rough Seas says this is kind of the reason why we need to legalize strip clubs. No, no, no. That was a joke, y'all. Oh, my God. Y'all are getting serious. Yeah, we posted that video over last week, over Easter. That was Thursday last week. Somebody sent me a video and said, hey, Sandy, look at what this person getting them some Easter weekend money twerking on this pole. I was like, Lord Jesus, I don't even know what to say. I do not know what to say. I'm just like, first of all, I think that only certain people should be twerking on a pole. I mean, I know I'm not the caliber person to be twerking on a pole. And some of you need to admit that you're not either and just stay off of it. Okay then. Anywho, y'all seem to be throwing dollar bills at her. So, I don't know what to say. Lord Jesus, take the wheel. Take the whole pole right out of there. Alejandra says that must have been a joke. It's a serious joke. Siobhan says, you don't know if you say certain things, you open up a can of possibility of trolling. Oh, my Lord. Good morning, Miss Norma. Leroy says that would be a heck of a show. Don't y'all even start thinking about it. Not in a million years. Well, they say never say never. But no, I'm at a particular age in life where It wouldn't even begin to make any sense. If I didn't have to do it in my 20s, I'm certainly not going to be doing it now. I can tell you that much. Mm-hmm. All right. So listen, a couple of things I want to touch upon before we do our K-Man Voices segment. First of all, I am shocked and appalled that this guy, I'm going to get his picture here for you guys, had the audacity to not even turn up for his court case. I'm confused by how he didn't turn up. I mean, he's sitting where and refusing to come. Normally, you have to come when the court summons you. So I'm a little bit confused by this. Did they issue a warrant for his arrest for not showing up to court? I don't know. But I tell you what I do know is, dude, you are a horrible person for starving poor little Wilbur the dog to death. What is wrong with you? I mean, poor Wilbur, my tweetum, he fought so hard. The poor thing had no meat on him. I mean, Lord Jesus. This is Warlito Damasco Samelo Jr., 48 years old, a Filipino national. He had a dog named Wilbur, found suffering in Prospect last year, and poor thing just couldn't make it because his body was just too weak. This is November. He died in early November after weeks of treatment. They really fought hard to try to save poor little Wilbur, and he just couldn't be saved. When you look at Wilbur's face, I have never seen a sadder face in a dog. Wilbur, his face just looks sad. You know, I can't believe that anybody could be so wicked to a poor animal. Good morning, caller. Hello?
Yeah, morning, Sunday.
Hi.
Yeah, morning. Boy, you see, those people that do stuff like this to dogs, boy, Sunday, it breaks my heart big time. You know how much it takes to starve a big dog like that? And I've seen it personally with situations where Humane Society get these type of animal cruelties and nobody is held accountable, because when the police comes, they just take a report and they throw it under the rug as if it was just animals. Mm-hmm. You know, like, yeah, mm-hmm. I understand they're just animals for real. Yeah, there are people's animals that they don't care for. Mm-hmm. And it's a crime to have children just like that. If you do stuff like that to children, what are you going to do as well? Yeah. You know, like, you consider these animals your children when you have a responsibility to feed them.
Absolutely.
And if you don't feed them, look here, starving a dog, it takes months to get a situation where they show bones like that.
Mm-hmm.
This is despicable when you see people just doing stuff like this. And yeah. Then you want to just see one little small foreign national getting prosecuted for it. You know, like, there's multiple Caymanians that do this thing too, you know, leave animals abandoned.
Yeah, it's unfortunate.
Abandoned. And I'm not just talking about, oh, yeah, this is just something we're skepticizing about. No, this is actual things that are happening, man.
Mm-mm. And very, it's very unfortunate.
My boss, you're calling me now, bro.
All right.
My boss, you're calling me now.
She's
2 years
old. Your boss is two.
Yeah, she's 2 years old, boy, and she got a vocabulary as brilliant as mine. Come on. Let's go inside. All right, Sandy.
All right,
yo, they have some people out there that they need to be prosecuted seriously, boy, Sandy.
Yes.
And then the police just scared to prosecute Caymanians, mm-hmm. especially. And the foreigners, they do it equally. But mm-hmm. what happened with the foreigners? They would show an example to the foreigners first, because they know the foreigners not gonna go and castigate them.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Thank
you. Happening, and I mean, anyways, you get the drift.
Yeah.
All right,
my dear. Thanks very much. Alejandro said his 2-year-old got a brilliant vocabulary like him. Yes, sir. So yeah, I mean, this is horrific. Poor Wilbur unnecessarily suffered because this man is just a horrible man. There's no other way to explain or describe what happened to Wilbur. Anybody who does this is, in my opinion, a sociopath. I mean, I can't imagine seeing a dog suffer, much less suffering at my own hands. Like, who does that? Who has a dog and does not feed them? You know, you don't have to have a dog. And I want to remind you guys of this. Dog ownership is optional. But to have a dog and then starve the poor dog to death, like what this man did to Wilbur, speaks to what a horrific individual he is. And then we hear that this really isn't the first time that this man has done something like this. I hope that he gets the maximum sentence. And then after serving the maximum sentence, he is deported. And just like how we need a sex offenders registry to protect children and other adults, we also need an animal cruelty registry. Look at poor Wilbur. You know what it takes to see a dog's ribs like that? And his collarbones and all the Wilbur couldn't even walk. This is a different level, in my opinion, of evil. So Michael says that POS should be given the max sentence, max fine, and then sent back to his peasant village he's likely from. Need to starve him in jail, in prison, says Leroy. Mm-mm. Siobhan says they may be just animals, but the animals don't deserve to be treated like this. If you're not going to take care of the animal, don't get one. My God, what a sick human being. And you have options, folks. If you can't afford your dog, just this past weekend, I had someone reach out to me and they said, Sandy, I need your help finding a home for my dog. I need my dog rehomed. It was already a rescue, but they just don't have the time because the dog is very, very high energy. And they're like, I don't have the time that the dog needs. The dog needs time and needs a proper environment and so forth. And I don't have that. And I know you have contacts. So, you know, they reached out to see how best to get the dog rehomed. And I was happy to be able to reach out to one of the animal rescue organizations on island. And they're going to be assisting him with rehoming the dog. That's what you do. What you don't do is you don't allow a dog to starve to death. So Warlito faces up to 1 year in prison, failed to provide food, shelter, and veterinary care for poor Wilbur, right? Found in Prospect last year. Following the dog's death, you guys know that there's a campaign that has been launched, a petition, which is going to be filed with the government. Hopefully they take that petition more seriously than the one with the kid. Well, not more seriously, but seriously at all. To really strengthen the country's animal protection laws to enable more effective prosecution for those who abuse animals. Well, if they don't care about children, I don't know if the legislators are going to care about the animals, but anyway, we'll see. So the matter was tried in Samello's absence after he reportedly told the court martial that he had to work. Dude still has a job. When he was told he was required to attend court. When he appeared in court on Wednesday, he told the magistrate that he had forgotten the court date. This dude just doesn't care. This dude is next level crazy. Magistrate Philippa McFarland said that it was the worst case of animal cruelty that she had seen. And Wilbur, who was starved to death, also reportedly had heartworm and hookworm. Instead of taking the animal to the vet for his condition, the court heard that Samello gave Wilbur medication from the Philippines. The dog was rescued by a neighbor. Samello's work permit, which expired in March, has been extended. Why? As he awaits the outcome of the trial, and he was released on bail and will return to work in 6 weeks for sentencing. Do we know where he works? I'm kind of curious about who has this man employed. Michael says, I'd like to take a basketball bat to the you-know-what expletives like that. Siobhan Berry says, I'll help you. Garrett says, what pet owner should do is to love them, feed them, care them, spoil them. Their lives are short and precious. Michael says he's utter scum. I agree, 1,000%. Deportation after he serves his sentence. This is horrible. Did you see the comment from someone else protecting him? No. Where was this? On Facebook? Somebody protecting him? Are y'all crazy? Hold on a second now. Y'all must be crazy. Who in their right mind would what? Okay, let me just have a look here. By the way, this somebody says, good morning. Can you please post your page? Carolyn Avisar, your American Express card has been found. Carolyn Avisar, A-V-I-S-A-R. We got your American Express card, honey chill. Give us a call. Anybody knows her? Give her a call. So I'm really shocked that that anybody So folks, yes, I was going to say that I'm really I completely lost my train of thought, but oh wow. Lord have mercy. Okay. Lordy. Mm-mm. Hold on folks, hold on. I'm really quite surprised and shocked that this man could do something like this, and I don't understand. He thought he was going to get away with this? Our laws do need strengthening, but he should get the maximum sentence. He should definitely get the maximum sentence. All right. So I think some of you are sending me, somebody sent me, I was trying to find this comment that you're referring to. Somebody did send me something this morning, but I'm trying to find it. I wonder if it's the same thing. You mean to tell me that people are defending him? I don't understand this. Oh, yes. Okay, so somebody said, okay, hold on. He's from the Philippines. Somebody's asking where he's from. Okay, so someone, I can't believe sometimes what y'all be posting, but anywho, I guess all in the name of freedom of speech, y'all can say the most ridiculous things. But let me show you this comment that has just come in. So someone just shared this, saying this morning, saying that this was on the story on social media. So this Ian Oscar says, I'm so sad that these people in the comment section are so quick to judge. Sometimes we care too much about animals that we forget to be human. What? We forget to be humane or human? Well, he has humane, so I'm not sure what he meant, but I don't know. My heart is broken for that poor dog, but we also have to realize that this guy came to Cayman to work. Maybe he's struggling to earn some money to take the dog to the vet. Maybe he's prioritizing his family in the Philippines. Uh-huh. I know this because I also have a dog that is way more worse than his dog. What the? Are you kidding me? I couldn't take him to the vet because I'm prioritizing my children's needs, but that doesn't mean that I don't love him. What do you think will happen if the guy gets imprisoned? How about his family? Oh, try to shut the hell up. Y'all are so stupid. You don't have to have a dog. What the hell? What is wrong with you people? You do not have, just like you don't have to have children. You know, these things are optional. Stop having children you can't feed either. Stop having dogs you can't feed. What the hell? This has got to be a joke. Nobody in their right mind could be posting something like this. Are y'all kidding me? If you can't afford something, don't have it. Y'all acting like somebody is forcing you to have a dog. Nobody's forcing you to be a dog owner. Nobody's forcing you to be a parent. Oh my God. What the hell is wrong with you people? And one person liked the comment, that person needs to have their head checked. Mm-mm-mm. Wow. Something wrong with y'all, you know? Something is seriously wrong. The fact that you could put that in writing really makes me wonder what on earth is going on here. Oh my God. Take several seats. Ian Oscar, Can we find out if Ian's a real person? And if he is, please take away any animals. This is the other thing. Some of y'all need to be banned from owning dogs. Nobody forces you to own a dog. You don't have to own a dog. But if you do, you have an obligation. And in fact, not taking care of the dog, let me be very clear, that is what's inhumane. A dog can't fend for itself. I don't care what your financial position is, because the option to give up the dog is always there. So do not keep an animal that you cannot afford. And yes, they cost money. Just like children, right? It costs money. You got to take them to the vet. You've got to do, you know, annual shots and checkups, and heaven forbid, they get sick, they break an arm, you know, things happen. So what you do, folks, is you just don't get the dog to it. Why do you have a dog? Ian Oscar, well, it looks like it's a real account. It says lives in the Cayman Islands, digital creator. Wow, dude, are you serious? Because you gotta send money back to the Philippines? That's fine. Nobody's begrudging you from sending money back to the Philippines. But the issue is you get a dog and you starve the dog to death? How does that work? You can't be a human being doing that kind of stuff. I mean, that's just ridiculous. I honestly don't even know what the hell you're talking about. Lord Jesus, take the wheel. Mm-mm. Donna says, I don't think they're kidding at all. Wow. Michael says, call the police and that SOB too. Oh my God. You come to the Cayman Islands and yes, you're here to work. And everybody understands that, you know, a large portion, it's not just Filipinos that are coming here to work to send money home. It's practically everybody that's here on a work permit. But that doesn't mean that you get to break the laws here. You can treat animals less than humane. I don't even know how you can claim to love an animal and treat it like this. That's something's wrong with you. You're psychotic. That's not love. That's abuse. That's straight up abuse. That's abuse, neglect. Like I would go without food before allowing a poor dog to starve to death. You know what I'm saying? The dogs, a lot of them don't even ask to be here. Y'all won't get them fixed, spayed and neutered. They're running amok. I mean, we really need to shape up animal rights and how we think about animals in this community. This is just deplorable and despicable. I mean, I'm just really shocked. Donna says there's enough scrapes on your plate to keep a dog alive. I mean, I don't believe in giving dogs scrapes either, but because I've seen some of y'all give dogs hot porridge, like hot where they can't even eat it. It's like burning their tongues and stuff. Y'all need some education about how to, if you want to be a dog owner, how to properly care for dogs. And it's unfortunate that we have, as Alejandro rightfully said, Caymanians are often some of the worst offenders when it comes to how they treat dogs. So Ruff sees what says, but Sandy, he comes from a country where they eat dogs, so he probably didn't know any better. Wouldn't you want a dog nice and fat if you're going to eat it? Not starving it to death, not taking care of it? Anyway, throw the book at this guy and then kick him off the island as quickly as possible. That's all I can say. This is just disgusting. Lillane says they don't get any dog or pet. Then don't get a dog or pet if you're not capable of giving needs to your pet. If you want to have pets, it's included that in your daily routine, expenses and time, keep them clean. That's how it should be. And listen, they are a responsibility. You know how many times I got to walk Zeus for the day? I'm already thinking right now. I'm coming off early to put on Cayman Voices. I got to walk Zeus. He's already been walked for the day. He gets fed twice a day, more if he wants. He gets snack. You got to play with him. You know, dogs have the intelligence. They can be as intelligent as a four-year-old child. So they might not speak our language directly, but dogs, oh my God, I can't believe anybody would mistreat a dog. You can teach them sign language. They know audio commands. They're great at reading body language. They're there for you no matter what. You want somebody who's ride or die, y'all. Someone, oh, I got a ride or die chick. No, you don't. You got a ride or die dog, because that dog will be there for you no matter what. They've discovered cancers. They've saved people's lives. Remember the lady who had breast cancer and her dog kept smelling her boob? And she's like, I think something's wrong. Sure enough, she had breast cancer. And the dog was picking up on that. Right? We've got service dogs who saves people's lives all the time. When people have, you know, seizures and other episodes, the dogs are there. A dog will give their life. They've jumped in pools and rivers and everything to save human beings. And this is the things that they get. Like, seriously? Take some special kind of POS to treat a dog like that. Any animal, really. But dogs, especially a man's best friend, as Ms. Morna rightfully said. And that's how we thank them. That's how we repay them. Well, I don't think that Wilmer's ill treatment and death should be in vain. It's just like the one lady who had the 40-something puppies in Prospect as well. No, was that Prospect or Palmdale? Somewhere in Georgetown. You know, she got all upset when we were talking about her animal cruelty case. Too many of these cases are happening. As far as I'm concerned, one is too many. We had the man who, back in 2022, was fined $2,000. He was a so-called professional. And again, the dog got injured and he doesn't allow the dog. This is Richard Washington Jones. He doesn't allow the dog to get the proper treatment. I mean, come on, people. Y'all can utilize just a little bit of common sense here. All right. They all make me sick. Like, seriously. Send his behind to jail. Folks, Cayman Voices, another segment brought to you again proudly by Cayman Mall Road. And of course, the DART organization is our premier sponsor for this. This one is, you know, I was so glad to have the opportunity to sit down with him. 80 years old, Mr. Andy Martin. You guys will know him undoubtedly as Cayman Cowboy Music. Grab your coffee, your tea, whatever your beverage of choice is. Sit back, folks, and have a listen and enjoyable time at this interview here today. Cayman Voices was a dream that I had for several years now. It's about taking the power of storytelling to embrace our own collective history as a people. Through our individual stories, we're able to see the common thread that binds us together as one. One person's personal journey has become our collective culture, heritage, and history. This series will show people from all walks of life sitting down with me as the host and going through their life journey. Sometimes they're unknown elements of their lives, but ultimately we're going to walk away having learned something new with every person that we sit down with. I guess I would explain it as an exploration of our story. I'm naturally curious about people and their lives, so Cayman Voices is exciting and allows me to capture this for everyone to enjoy. We are seeking out Caymanians, multi-generational, as well as some who have moved here to, you know, uproot their entire lives and to make this their home. This dream would not be possible without some sponsorship, and so I'd like to thank the DART organization for stepping up to the plate to ensure that we're able to deliver regular monthly content for our viewers to enjoy. So sit back, kick up your feet, turn up the radio, relax, and listen to Cayman Voices. All right, folks, so we're here for another segment of Cayman Voices. I'm so tickled pink to be sitting here with Mr. Andy Martin. So he's gonna talk to us all about life, a day in the life of. So tell us how you're 80 years old.
Yeah, I just turned 80. December the 23rd.
All right. Wow. I reckon in 80 years, you've seen a lot of changes in Cayman.
Oh, yes, a lot.
Yeah.
Well, I've been here now 52 years. I moved from Cayman Brack in 1972.
In 72?
Oh. The very same day in May, I forgot the date that their money changed over from Jamaican money to to Cayman money.
Okay.
And I've been here ever since. Of course, I made a lot of trips back to Cayman Brack.
Yeah. They say once a
Bracken,
always a
Bracken. Yeah. Well, I was a seaman and I did that for 12 years.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I had an accident in Cayman Brack, lost my first cousin. And that's why I came here. And you had to come to Grand Court, but they threw the case in. You know, it was no crime.
Yeah.
And I didn't want to go back to sea. I didn't want to go back to Cayman Brack. So I said, you know what, I might as well just stay here and work.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So let's rewind then. We'll go back maybe 75 years ago. I don't know if you remember anything before that age, but what was it like growing up in the Brack when you were born?
Well, life wasn't easy.
Yeah.
I know, well, I was adopted. Not with papers, but, you know, because my mother died when I was only 5 months old.
Oh, wow.
She died on her way to Jamaica, on the Simbogo. And a good friend of hers was with her.
The Simbogo?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And a good friend of hers was with her. And she told her whether she lived or died, she wouldn't give me to her, you know?
Yes.
But 2 years later, my father got married again.
Okay.
And she told me that when I got older, you know, but I didn't want to go. I mean, our house wasn't far from hers, but I didn't care about going.
Yeah.
But after a while, you know, his second wife started having kids, and you know, it was a tough life. All the kids he had was six of them by his last wife, and it was five by my mother.
Wow.
But one of them died. The second one died. He was named and named me after him.
Oh, I see.
So then, when I was about 6 years old, I went and stayed with this woman.
Wow.
And she raised me.
I find that actually quite a bit of that happened back in the day, you know.
Oh, yes.
It might have been a neighbor or family member or something like that. You just went and stayed with them and, you know, you call the person aunt or mama or whatever.
Yeah.
But
life wasn't easy. I mean, but she was married.
Mm-hmm.
She had some kids before she got married to her last husband, which was, he had a leg amputated. So she raised me. So she and I did all the work.
Yes.
Woman and man work, you know, everything. I used to have to go pick wilts in the morning before I go to school.
You had to pick?
Pick wilts.
Wilts, okay.
To get them for dinner when I come home.
Yeah.
And we used to do farming on the bluff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she used to raise cows and chickens, and life wasn't easy, but I enjoyed it and made a man out of me, you have to say.
Yeah. You know, so many of our young people, Mr. Andy, now they complain about life now. And I tell you what, doing these series that came on Voices have really opened up my eyes, because the truth of the matter is we've never had life better.
Exactly.
Than we do now, but we complain more.
Yeah.
So I find it hard to sometimes explain how that works, but
the old folks, you know, they made it with what they had. They didn't have no air conditioner or no washing machine or no big house, but they didn't have a big mortgage to pay either,
right?
You know,
yes. And I guess if they never had it, they didn't necessarily know any other life, so they just made do.
Call them the good old days.
The good old days, that's right. So back in those days, do you remember how many people would have been living in Cayman Brack? I don't reckon it was many.
No, I would say about 800 the most.
Right.
Because when I came here in 72, it was only a couple, it was only about 2,000 or 3,000 people.
And Grand Cayman.
Yeah. It wasn't that many. Might have been more than that, but wasn't that much.
Yeah, wasn't that much, yeah. Wow. So in the Brack, everybody knew everybody back in
Everybody,
the
still like that. Everybody knew everybody.
Yeah. What was your favorite part of being a young boy growing up in Cayman Brack, would you say?
My favorite part?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I always liked to fish.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I used to listen to country music, and my sister had a radio. So I used to go to her place and listen to the country music, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I always wanted a guitar.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I lost interest in the school because of the guitar.
Okay.
But I still made it to what we call sixth standard, you know,
elementary
school. And I never forget, I bought this little guitar for £7. That's $14 of today's money.
Okay.
Mr. B.B. Grant had them selling, and I worked on the road. those days it wasn't a roller to pee or nothing. It was sand roller.
Yes.
But the woman that raised me got a job with her next door neighbor who was headed to road work, you know. And he got me a little job there. I was about 12.
Okay.
Or 11, something like that. And I saved enough money to get the little guitar. Yeah.
Wow.
So and that was my favorite part, fishing and you know, with my friends
and, playing,
and learning to play the guitar.
Yeah. So tell me about the guitar. Why did you said you would listen to country music. Is that kind of what made you think, oh, I could pick up a guitar and maybe sing one day?
Yes. Because I listened to all those old guys, you know, Hank Williams, Jim Reeves, Conway. Well, a lot of them wasn't around yet, you know, there's Hank Williams and all those guys. And my uncle had a Rick Troller, a big troller, but it was a turntable, you know. Mm-hmm. Those days were 78 records.
Mm-hmm.
And I, my grandmother, my step-grandmother, I was staying with her at first, you know. And I would climb up and wind it. Then you had to wind them up, you know.
You had to wind them up?
Yes. Oh, wow. Yeah. And then say play, and then it started, the record started to slow down. I had to wind her up again.
Wind it up again. Wow.
But I wanted to hear all those songs, you know, and I was learning those songs from then. All the Cayman Islands was in, and that was the first music we knew, country music.
Yes.
And I, because it was the fact that the seamen went to sea and they sent home or brought home those records. And I did the same thing when I went to sea too.
Yeah. I heard this story once. You can tell me if this is true, but I heard that actually when people first started to get radios, the one frequency they could kind of get, I guess, was a station out of Texas. So we would get country music.
Yes, you're right. And then we had a radio coming out of Miami, I think, too. Called, the guy was named Cracker Jim, the DJ. And he used to play a lot of country music, too. Okay. I forgot the radio station in but I know what you're talking about in Texas. Mm-hmm. We used to listen to that too, yeah.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah. So love of music from a very, very early age. Did you take any formal lessons at all, or you just picked it up and?
Yeah, and well, I didn't learn to play the guitar that well. I could strum and all of it, not pick.
Yes.
But because I guess the singing took that away, you know. Mm-hmm. And then when I got older, that I came down here, I had lost piece of my finger, so I just used to play the guitar for writing songs when I was, you know, songs.
Yeah, we're going to talk more about your songwriting and musical life here in a second. So you said then there was an unfortunate accident with you and your cousin and the Brac, and then after that you decided to move to Grand Cayman. Did you leave your adopted mom in Cayman Brac at that time?
I left her. She died in 1995, she lived to be 95 too.
Oh my gosh, that's wonderful. So, what age then would you have gone off to sea?
I left home on the 16th of December 1959, and I spent my 23rd, my 16th birthday in New York, Staten Island, on a ship.
Oh.
I turned 16.
Wow.
Cold.
Yes. Yes.
So I went from when I was, almost 16. And I did it for 12 years.
Wow.
And after, in 71, then I retired from it. Of course, I did vacations too. You know, my first trip away, I was gone for 2 years.
What was the hardest part for you about being off to sea?
Missing home.
You just missed home?
Yeah, I missed home. I never did get used to the sea, you know.
Yeah.
We had to do it for a living, but I never did get, you know. I mean, I enjoy going from port to port and all those places. We can look back and say we've been to those places, but we wasn't there as a tourist. We were just visiting. Because we go ashore and we got to take some money and get a Western Union check. We get that, and after that, we do a little shopping and we got to buy some clothes. After that, we hit the bars, you know? So we really never been anywhere, if you know what I'm saying.
Yes, yeah.
As a tour, you know, to see any place.
What are some of the places that you were able to travel to?
Oh, I've been to Venezuela, Brazil, Amsterdam, England, Italy, all over.
All over.
My favorite port was like from Venezuela to Mobile, Alabama.
Wow.
That was bringing iron ore to Mobile. That was one of my favorite ports.
Yes. But what did you do on the ship? What was your
Well, of course, my first job like most was a mess man.
Right.
Making $90 US a month, but that was a lot of money then. You could do a lot with that.
That was good money.
Yeah. And I worked my way up to a junior engineer, but I didn't bother to go any higher.
Yeah.
I got a brother, Adley Martin, I don't know if you know him, but he stayed with us as captain.
Oh yeah.
And then I had another brother, Gary, he went on to be chief engineer.
Wow.
But I didn't go up no higher than junior engineer. Yeah. I wasn't interested in studying and all that.
Yeah. Okay. All right, so you did your little stint at sea.
Yeah.
Were you married at all during that time? Did you start a family?
No.
Nope. You were just living the good single life.
Yep. Had a lot of women. But never did have any kids.
Okay.
I never got married till I was like 42. I didn't get married. I met my wife in 42 or 43. I mean, at the age of 42.
At the age of, yeah. Oh, wow.
And she was like 23. Mm. I'm 19 years older than her.
Okay.
Well, I would have been living there with an 80-year-old woman, I think.
Yeah. You were a late bloomer.
Yeah, I'd like young women.
Yeah, all right.
So I didn't get married till I was, you know. But we were together from 1986. Mm-hmm. I would go up there to visit her. She'd come here. And then mm-hmm. she moved here in 1988.
Okay.
And she got a job at the hospital, and she's been working there ever since.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It's like 35 years now, I think. She says she's going to soon retire.
Yeah. All right. Wonderful. That's beautiful.
But we never had any kids.
You never had any kids. Okay.
And I thank God for that.
Yeah. It's not for everybody, trust me. They say, I was actually talking about that, I think it might have been this morning, but they say that people who are don't have any children tend to be happier, you know, because kids come with a lot of stress, I suppose.
Oh boy. Yes. I see your little girl be on your Facebook thing.
Yeah,
yesterday I was going.
She's 7 years old now.
I was going to hit it to actually accept me as a, you know.
Oh, okay.
But I never did do it.
Yeah, that's okay. Yeah, she's 7 now. But so you come back to see, what did you do when you decided then to come back? You said, all right, I had enough of the sea life. You came back. What did you do for a career? What sort of work?
Well, I was a bartender. I used to work at the Buccaneers then. We used to work at Blackie's Bar. That's what I did.
Okay.
And of course, I used to sing with the Beach Boys. You probably heard about it in the Beach Boys. Mm-hmm. That's Berman's dad.
Yes.
I used to sing with him. And I would get a little work here and there, you know, but it wasn't hard to get, I mean, it wasn't easy to get work.
Yeah, it was hard in those days.
Yeah, but we saved a little money, you know, so most of us guys, all we did was drink. Some guys was home that was broke and they waiting on somebody to come home to buy some drinks for them.
Yes, there wasn't a lot of stress, I suppose, in those days to, you know, do much of anything. You had a little roof over your head. Couple friends, you were good. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you did a couple little bartending job here and there. Continued the singing and playing of your guitar. When did you start to write music?
Well, when I came here in 72, mm-hmm. I was working construction with Arch and Godfrey.
Oh, okay.
And I never looked on singing as that I could be a recording artist.
Yeah.
No. I thought those people in Nashville were different from, they were special people that did that. That's how I look. You know, I never had a dream of one day I'm going to be a recording artist.
Okay.
No, nothing like that.
Right.
But I think it was around 74.
Mm-hmm.
The Barefoot Man was working at the Galleon Beach.
Mm-hmm.
And he was getting ready to have a country show. People singing country music,
mm-hmm.
you know, and they took the audience as the judges.
Right.
Give them a piece of paper and who's your favorite singer for the night, you know?
Okay.
And a friend of mine from Cayman Rock, he was working at the Galleon Beach as a painter. And he said to Barefoot, I got a friend from Cayman Rock that can sing good country music.
Okay.
So Barefoot said, well, tell him to come on down and practice, you know, and see what happens.
Mm-hmm.
So I went down there. When he did, with the helmet on, everything.
Mm-hmm.
And I practiced 2 songs, and he said, that's good enough, you're okay.
Okay.
And then that night they had the show, and I brought the house down.
Wow. So it sounds like you just probably had natural talent.
Natural.
Yeah.
A gift from God.
Yeah.
Some people have it, some don't.
Yeah.
It's like everything else.
Yeah.
You know, you got people who paint, do construct anything. Yeah. It's a gift. Some can do it better than others, you know.
Absolutely.
It's not true.
Yeah.
So, wow.
So you brought the house down, and that night you said, maybe there's something more to this.
Yeah, but I still wasn't thinking about recording the thing, you know.
Yes.
But I met the bartender there, Alberto, the head bartender of the nightclub.
Okay.
And he said, would you be interested in doing some bartending? I said, well, I got a little experience. I can't mix those fancy drinks like what the tourists do, but I can serve a rum and coke and a beer.
Mm-hmm.
He said, I need somebody. You want to come and work? I said, sure.
Okay.
And I did bartending for 36 years.
Wow.
So that was the main job.
Yes.
Know?
Okay.
Because you couldn't make a living here from singing anyway, you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So then it wasn't long after that, about a month or so after I started bartending, the Barefoot Man said to me if I was interested in doing some recording. And I said, come on, man, I can't sing good enough to record. He said, Andy, you sing better than some of those guys that made it. Johnny Cash don't sing. He talks at a tone. So, come on, man. So he started looking for a song to bring me out with. And a song that the locals and the tourists
could appreciate.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then he said to me, you know a guy named Stubby that dresses like a cowboy? You ever heard of him? Stubby, his name is Kenneth Ebanks, but they called him Stubby.
Okay.
And Stubbs for Tubbs, because Ornette Stubbs was a big singer too, you know.
Uh-huh.
And he used to dress like a cowboy. I mean, cowboy hat, shirt, boots, jeans. He even had the spurs on his shoulders.
Oh, yeah?
Guns, but you mean toy guns, you know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And his guitar strapped around his shoulder. I mean, he could play a guitar and sing also.
Yeah.
He used to sing with a band that Elon Parrs had here. He was a big, used to play with him.
Okay.
So he was married to a girl from Cayman Brac. And as a young boy coming out of school, Stubbard would wait on us guys to play cowboy with him.
He was obsessed with cowboys.
Yeah. So they moved down here later on, and he stayed here for years, and then they got old and moved back.
Yeah.
So I explained everything to George about him, and he wrote the song. Cayman Cowboy. That was my first recording.
What was it called?
Cayman Cowboy.
Cayman Cowboy.
You never heard that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
He went to Jamaica to record it.
Right.
And so it made a hit locally.
Mm-hmm.
And every day that I went to town, everybody that saw me, hey, Cayman Cowboy. Hey, Cayman Cowboy. Hey. I said, I'm not the Cayman Cowboy. Yeah, you're Cayman Cowboy. They didn't even listen to the words, and it don't say I'm a Cayman cowboy. And I said he's a Cayman cowboy.
Yeah.
And so he calls his island his home on the range. Right. We wrote the song about this guy. You see.
Yes, yes, yes.
You know.
You were instant hit then, celebrity.
Yeah, just like that.
Yeah. Wow.
So after about a year or so, I guess George said to me one day, he said, "You know what? You need a stage name. Let's call you Cayman Cowboy." So that's how I got
that's
that
how you
name.
Got the stage name.
And all I had that was anything to do with a cowboy was the hat.
Yes.
And the country music.
And you love country music.
I never rode a horse in my life. I didn't know nothing about a horse.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
But that name stuck, you know.
That stuck.
Yeah.
Wow, that's so fascinating. Huh. So you only did the one song initially recorded in Jamaica, or did you have other songs?
I had other songs,
you
too.
You did a whole album.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I did this on a 45, you know, I released it first with a, I think the flip side was another song that I wrote.
Okay.
Because I wrote quite a few songs
when
I was in Cayman Brac before I met him or anything, but I wasn't just singing them with my friends and, you know, I wasn't thinking about recording or anything.
Right.
But I did record those songs on the same album, you know, it was a LP that we did in Jamaica.
Hmm.
And
beautiful.
Rest is history.
Yeah, as they say.
And I must have
so been, you I continued guess. To bartend, and then basically with bartending and music?
Yes. I bartended. And when he left the Galleon, then he moved to Holiday Inn. And I was still at the Galleon because the guy left the Galleon, him and the guy that was manager, and they moved up to the airport to manage up there. So I became the manager then of the club. But in the evening, when I wasn't working, then I would go down to the Holiday Inn and go on stage and sing a few songs. Especially when I did a recording to promote it, I would go down there.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm sure over those years you must have met all kind of tourists, probably some celebrities and.
Oh man.
Everybody.
Well, I know. I mean, when we went to Nashville a couple of times. One time, this country singer Larry Gatlin invited us. Mm-hmm. That was back in 1984, I think.
Okay.
And he gave us the musician tag to play, you know. And we could go backstage at the Grand Ole Opry, you know.
Wow.
One time they had things going on there for a whole week in memory of some woman that had owned a bar and restaurant. We all the musicians, Willie Nelson, all of them would hang around to, you know, write the songs and play, you know. And they had this tribute to her, and I was backstage every night meeting people. And when I met them, I already knew them because I used to read the country song around that books. I still got a bunch of them up in there. Mm-hmm. So I knew the artists by their face the minute I see them, you know.
You knew who they were.
Yeah.
Yeah. Nice. And they were probably surprised. Yeah. Somebody from this little place called the Caymans. I'm sure that they didn't even know where the Caymans was. Knew who they were.
Yeah, well, I know when the guy brought, because the Treasure Island was owned by a guy from Nashville, you know, and he had a lot of owners, singers come with him, those that own a part of it, you know, and they came down and did a show one time called the Nashville Now.
Ah, okay.
And I'll never forget, some of them came into the bar, you know, at night, and this singer, I don't know if you heard about him, Mel Tillis. He was a stuttering singer. He stuttered.
Okay.
But he didn't stutter when he started. He's just like Pluto. You heard about Pluto? Just died. Pluto stuttered too.
But when they sang,
it's just gone.
Yes.
You know?
Wow.
And he made a lot of hits. He wrote a lot. He sang a lot. And he came into the bar with a drink, and I said, Mr. Mel Tillis. Oh, he said, hi, how are you?
Mm-hmm.
What do you know about me? I said, I'm a favorite singer of yours, I'm a fan of yours, man.
Mm-hmm.
And I started singing a few of his songs, you know, and I began asking about different albums. And
right.
He did an album with Sinatra's daughter, Nancy Sinatra.
Okay.
And I said, but I never heard more about that. He said, no, that didn't get off the ground. He said, you know that too. He said, you know more about me than I know about myself.
Oh my goodness.
Remember the first time I met Charlie Pryor too up there, you know. I told him I was from, he never heard about the Cayman Islands. He said he was going to islands called the Fiji Islands. I said, no, that's far away from us.
Yes. Very far.
About 4 or 5 years later, I guess, the Lions brought him here. And I wrote a song, Beth and I wrote a song about him. I don't know if you knew about that.
No. Yeah, I can get you to tell me more about these songs here in a minute. You still have your guitar handy? We might have to, I don't know if you feel like pulling it out, but we might have to pull it out today. So, wow, I mean, that's
but
amazing.
But I can't play it anymore because of this.
Yeah, no, that's okay. But it's amazing that you had, you know, this exposure to musicians. You had the opportunity to go abroad, to see them, to meet them in person. How did that influence some of your music then? You know, being around, like listening to country music is one thing. You obviously fell in love with it from a very early age, but actually having access to the musicians and the artists themselves, did you find that impacted you as well?
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And I learned a lot from meeting them too and watching them perform, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I got a lot of stage appearance from them, you know, all that kind of thing.
Right.
And
that's beautiful.
And we went all over the states performing, you know. We used to go to Chicago, they used to call it a Chicago, Cayman Night in Chicago.
Okay.
Then in Port Arthur, Texas, where a lot of Caymanians used to live.
Mm-hmm.
We used to have Cayman Nights in Chicago, in Port Arthur, Texas.
Right.
And Houston.
Wow. So you guys were the original country musicians from the Caymanians.
Yeah, it was all promo for the island.
Mm-hmm.
Because in performing, you know, away, it brought tourists here.
Of course.
Yeah.
I remember it wasn't that long ago that even in Tampa, you know, I grew up in Tampa, people would be like, the Cayman Islands, where is that? That was the early 80s before they started having the direct route. And they would say, the Cayman Islands, I don't know that place. Is that Jamaica? They always used to say, is that Jamaica or the Bahamas? Because that was the places they really knew the Caribbean.
I know, yeah.
And I would say, no, we're a totally separate little island, close to Cuba, close to Jamaica. And then when Cayman Airways first started going direct to Tampa, they used to play the song, Those Who Know Us Love Us. And everybody would, oh, the Cayman Islands. Yes, I hear this commercial. So, you know, I guess we've all been ambassadors for our country.
Yes.
You know.
Well, you know, Mr. Manon Tibbetts was from Cayman, right? And that's where he made his money.
Right.
He went there with $7 in his pocket, he told me.
Yeah.
He became a millionaire. Cox Lumber.
Yes, 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 yes. That's right. Yeah, Caymanians have managed to go far and wide and really do a lot of wonderful things.
Yeah.
Did you ever think about living anywhere else? I mean, you traveled quite a bit.
Not really.
No.
I always wanted to come back home.
Yes. Yeah.
Always wanted to come back home.
Yeah, beautiful. Very, very beautiful. All right, so you did a little bit of traveling, you were bartending. Man, you must have seen a lot as a bartender as well, I imagine.
Oh, man.
Some of that might be state secrets you get, share any of that.
And I used to sell a lot of cassettes behind the bar too, you know.
Okay.
I would tell them that I records and all of this. And
uh-huh.
What I would do is, well, they said, I would give them a cassette.
Yes.
And they would say, we need an autograph. I said, no, that's gonna cost you. As a joke, you know?
Yeah.
But I would give it to them.
Yeah.
And at the end of, when they're leaving, they would leave me $200 tip. So that paid for the $10 for the cassette, and I got a big tip. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, of course. Absolutely.
And I used to crack a lot of jokes behind the bar. On stage, I couldn't say anything.
Yeah.
I just go up and sing. I couldn't. Well, Willie Nelson and Conway Twitty said they didn't come to talk, they came to sing.
Right. Yes.
I couldn't find nothing to say on stage, but behind the bar, I would, you know, give a lot of jokes and a lot more dirty jokes too. It depends on the people.
Yeah,
you know,
of course.
But I used to, and I used to make a lot of tips. Those days, it was your personality that gave you the tip.
Right.
These days, they put it on as a part of a salary, 15%. I hear it's gone up to 18% now. Gratuity. That's terrible, man. Mm-hmm. And the waitresses and the bartenders don't get it, much of it. Mm-hmm. It has to be shared.
Split up, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So personality is everything when you're in certain jobs.
Exactly.
Sure. Yeah.
Music didn't build this house, it was bartending, the tips.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, I know, that's wonderful. So 37 years you basically bartending for?
About 36.
About 36 years. Wow, that's a long time. So you were, tell us the different places then that you worked as a bartender.
Well, I started out as at the Galleon.
Right.
And then I went to the Caribbean Club.
Okay.
And then I went for a while up at the airport.
Mm-hmm.
And then I came back and I went to Treasure Island open. I went there.
Mm-hmm.
And I closed the nightclub down. I was there 10 years. And they wasn't doing any more business. In order to do business, they had to bring bands in, you know, and a band can only do its over and over and over songs, you know.
Right.
After a week or two, then they send them away and get another. So I was there 10 years, and they closed the nightclub down. Silver's long, John Silver's ever called.
Right, yeah.
And then they put me out in the lobby. Mm-hmm. But I didn't like out there. After about 2 months, I said no. I said, you know what, I go into the Hyatt and job. So I went up there. And the guy, an Irish guy, he said, look, we don't have anything open now, Mr. Martin, but you can check back later on.
Mm-hmm.
They had a place across from the Hyatt, I don't remember the name, out on the beach.
Mm-hmm.
Then at the Hyatt, they had a nightclub with two bartenders, two over there, that's four.
Mm-hmm.
They had a bar by the pool with three, and they had 1 point lease. And they had the bar over there with about three bartenders.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And one in the nightclub in the night. And I told him, I said, I mean that all of them, and everyone were foreigners. And I told him, I said, I gotta tell you right now, sir, I don't know which one going, but one of those jobs is mine.
Right.
Yeah, I can bring my resume and show you.
Yes.
Blah, 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 blah. A week later, he called me.
Mm-hmm.
He said, you got the job. You want that at the Hyatt or Rum Point? I said, I'll take Rum Point.
Mm-hmm.
But I had to stay at the Hyatt and work each bar and get used to it just in case they needed me to come down and, you know.
Yes.
And then they sent me to Rum Point. That was in 97.
Oh, okay.
And I stayed there till 2004, and I turned 60 and I retired.
You retired after that. Yeah.
And 2004, and that was September the 4th. and the 12th, the hurricane came.
My goodness, yes.
And I didn't have no, my pension was $4,800 because it only started in
just a couple years
in 97. Yeah. So I got $4,800. Mm-hmm. Well, I didn't have much damage, about $10,000 worth of damage. So that was the end of my life, $4,800.
Yes. Wow.
But I retired, and I've been retired ever since. But I continued singing.
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
But mm-hmm. I haven't been singing now either because since I got the COVID, mm-hmm. it gave me shortness of the breath, you know? Because I had a heart failure and blood clots and lungs and things. So I get out of breath. When I go to church, if I stand up in the audience and I sing a song, I get out of breath. So I haven't sung in a while.
Okay.
But so, the voice is still pretty good, you know?
Yeah. It's just it sounds good and strong when you're talking anyway.
Yeah.
So tell me now, you started out really not knowing anything about bartending, but you must have learned how to make a lot of drinks over the years.
Oh, yeah. Taught me just about everything.
Yeah.
And some of them were simple, you know, but I mean like a martini. That's pure gin with a little bit of vermouth.
Yeah.
Well, a lot of the drinks I forgot now, you know.
Yeah.
Because
you
had the Manhattan, the this and that. But I learned them. And then I got books to read from him to tell you the things about alcohol. You know, how the alcohol, all these things were made.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah.
All these liqueurs and things.
Because
He was a good bartender. He, you might know his daughter, Rita.
Rita
Estimanovich or something.
Oh, yeah.
The one I'm talking about is her father.
Okay.
He worked for years at the Botanic Park.
Yeah, and he used to be at Dirty Reeds.
Right.
Yes.
You got it.
That's right.
But he moved back, you know.
Okay.
She said that he wants to come back, but there's no way for him to live.
Yeah.
He went back, and since he went back, he lost his twin brother too. He had a twin brother.
Yeah, that's right. I remember. Mm-hmm. Oh my goodness.
So he was the one that taught me all of this.
All of these drinks and stuff. Wow. And I mean, you had to be willing to learn. You know, this.
Oh, definitely. Sure.
Yeah. We have somebody.
And we had a guy too that came down from Bahamas, and he did a bartender course at the Holiday Inn, and a lot of us people went to it. And, we got the little thing, you know.
Yeah. Very good.
The children these days are not interested in waitressing and bartending. They say they came on this, can't get no jobs, they don't want it. The ones I'm talking about.
Yeah, of
course. So, I mean, you go to all those hotels and the bars and then, you know, you don't see no Caymanians because they don't want it. But now they say that the money's too small. And the money was small in our time too. Mm-hmm. A half a bread is better than none.
absolutely. And I tell you what, like you said, you weren't even guaranteed a tip. You just had to make sure.
Exactly.
You know, you made your customers happy.
Yes. You might have a problem at home, but you take that frown off and you go to work.
Mm-hmm.
Manager at Treasure Island told me that one time. I said, "Sir, that's not easy, you know. It's not easy to take it off. We got our problems too, but we got to do what I do a lot, fake smile."
Yes, absolutely.
It's like a stewardess, fake smile.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So, you've had a very interesting life, I would say, for sure. Tell us a little bit about when you were bartending, you know, what were some of the challenges you faced? You said, you always weren't in the mood, but, you know, you knew you had to put on a good face and entertain people. Were there any times that you just had that customer that was impossible to deal with?
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Especially the locals.
The locals, they were some of the worst?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
And they never tipped. You would have to beg them for a tip. They never tipped.
Mm-hmm.
Some of those guys, you know, the older guys and things that had to tip and things, you know what I'm talking about? So much of those guys just used to run around hooking up the tourists to give them ganja and all that sort of thing, you know?
Right.
And
many times
I had to tell them, you know, we had a securities working. I remember one night at Treasure Island, I said to this security, I said, "That guy's drunk, you know."
Mm-hmm.
"Well, what do you expect if you serve him drinks?" I said, "Yeah, but he's going around harassing people,
yes,
sir."
Yeah.
"You can't see that? But you know, I find out from that from behind the bar and the stage, you can see more than anybody. But anyhow, but he should have been looking around, and you know, and these guys would go to a couple, you know, and I want to dance. Frightened the woman, but she got him dance, you know. And then another few minutes, you go again, and the guy said, "Let me go and dive in the morning, sir." So we leaving now. They actually ran them away.
Wow.
If you know what I mean.
Yes.
So I went, had to go through with a lot like that with them.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah. And some of them would come in the bar and they would come there drunk, you know?
Oh, my gosh.
And I would serve them. But what I would do is just pour the Coke or the ginger ale or 7-Up and just put a little bit on top. So they taste that and they think, you know?
Oh, yes.
After a while, one guy would say, "Man, I think I got getting sober." I said, "Yeah, well, you got a car, you need to get sober to drive." But that's what I used to do with a lot of them, you know?
Yeah.
And sometimes when I wouldn't serve them, they would get vexed with me, cuss me off.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, cuss me off. Mm-hmm. But then, you know, when they come back next weekend, they say, "I'm that sorry.
Mm-hmm.
You, I was wrong. You were right. I'm sorry about that." So,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's all right.
Mm-hmm.
I know even some big shot guys that used to come in there, you know, in 10 minutes, you order your last drink.
Yes.
And after that, then they still want drinks. And I said, "No, I'm sorry. I can't do it." "Oh, well, thanks a lot." I said, "Oh, you're welcome." I used to go by the rules.
Yeah, you had to cut them off and you had to come off.
So I used to have a hard time with a lot of locals more than the tourists. You know, once in a while, I'd have a little problem with them. I remember a guy from the States. I don't know what part you're from. But anyway, he ordered one or two drinks. And he gave me a quarter tip.
Mm-hmm.
I said, "Here, put that towards your first
a
key.
Quarter, like a 25 cents?"
Yeah.
"What?"
He said, "Put that towards," and that was a U.S. quarter too. He said, "Put that towards your first Cadillac."
Oh my gosh.
I said, "Sir, I don't own a Cadillac and I don't want a Cadillac."
Uh-huh.
You know?
Uh-huh.
"But anyway, I'll take the quarter. But you know what you should have done with that? Put a bit of sunshine."
Uh-huh.
He said, "What did you say?" I said, "Have a good sunshine day tomorrow." I said, because when you talk fast, I can't understand what you're saying, you know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I didn't want him to understand because he might have been to the manager. But
yes.
A quarter, I mean.
That was an insult for sure.
Big insult.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, my gosh. He's trying to be rude.
I know.
I tell you.
But you had other ones that would give you more than you were supposed to get for the few drinks they had, you know? But I enjoy that, being a bartender. I always say, people think it's easy, you know, it's not that simple.
Mm-hmm.
I always say that everybody should have at least 2 or 3 days behind a bar to see what it's like, especially when and you're dealing with drunkards, a lot of drunkards and things, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. They come in sober and after a few drinks, they start to get high. And, I used to get good and drunk too, and I used to drink.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I didn't, I wasn't boiling or not. I would just go into that. Many times I'd go into the hall day, "Hey!" Shout out. F it.
Yeah.
Barefoot says, "Security, get Andy out of here." And the security would say, "But he running you out and he's your best friend?"
Yeah.
I said, "No, but what he's saying is true."
Uh-huh.
You know? He had a guitar player in there one time with him.
Yeah.
And his girlfriend, the guitar player girlfriend, was dancing with somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
And he walked off the stage and with the guitar, and he was going to hit the guy or hit the girlfriend. The girlfriend told him, "Don't ever do that again, man."
Mm-hmm.
He didn't fire him, but he almost did it.
Wow.
"Yeah, you can't do that."
Yeah.
If you don't want her in here because she's going to dance, tell her to stay home.
Right.
But every time I used to get high and go in there, he would tell security, "Andy's in drunk." I just used to do it for the fun of it.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Live your life, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. So you said you took your time getting married in your early 40s then. So you found this lovely lady. Where is she from?
She's from Cayman Brighton.
She's from Cayman Brighton. Okay.
All the women I've been with, I met up. I need to bluff and pick their wife.
Yeah, that's very, very interesting. You went back to your roots.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you found yourself a nice
Cayman Brat
girl.
Yeah.
Okay, nice.
We got married in 1990, so that's 30 odd years now.
Oh, yeah.
We were together from 8 to 6.
Mm-hmm. And so you just lived a nice, quiet life with her. You built your home here in Lower Valley. When did you build this home? It's nice.
I built it in, I got married in 90, and then I built this in 91.
Okay. All right.
I went to Vegas and got married.
Oh, you got married?
Yeah, not because I wanted to get married in Vegas, but I used to go there anyway. Almost every vacation I'd go in.
Okay.
You know, play little slot machines, and I love Vegas. Yeah.
Nice.
And I told Sue, my wife, I said, if we get married in Cayman, I'm going to have to invite so many friends because I'm kind of popular, you know. I'm going to get married, say, at the Lions. I said, you know what? That's going to probably cost me about $34,000. I said, you know what? I'm going to go in Vegas. We put up the thing here on the post office. Yeah. We get down there and get married cheap, cost nothing,
right,
and come back and start my home.
That's smart.
Yeah.
Very, very smart.
And we got married, I think the pastor didn't charge me anything. He just said, give something for the, you know. And then we had to get another license there. And I think it was, she bought my little ring and I bought hers. And then we rented the clothes, I think was about $2,000. But that included everything for her, my suit, shoes, her, for everything. You know?
Yeah.
So in the end, it worked out cheap. I mean, you had to pay the tickets to go down there and all, but it still worked out cheap.
Yeah, you would have probably been there anyway.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And this piece of land I bought from in the 80s.
Okay.
It was up for sale. The guy next door was selling it. He wanted to put a top on his house.
Mm-hmm.
And it was going for $11,000.
Wow.
At that time, I was with another girl.
Yeah.
And She was the one that talked about buying a piece of land.
Mm-hmm.
After we separated then, she said, well, she had just bought a car. So she said, I need a car for work.
Mm-hmm.
So you'll have to finish paying on a piece of land. I take a car. I said, yeah. And then your car is gone. I can still have my piece of land.
Absolutely.
And I had that here from, I think it was either 3 or something like that.
Wow.
It just sat here until I was
ready to build on it.
In 91, yeah.
Yeah, beautiful.
And now it's valued at $100,000, just a little piece of land, 0.29 of an acre.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, beautiful. That's what you had to do back then.
Yeah.
And you bought it, you were able to get it on terms, and you said you're paying down on it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I put it to the belt in where I had in the bank, and then I went and borrowed the rest of paid, you know. And
yeah.
In 10 years, we paid it off. Like $1,200, I think, $1,265 a month. You paid $600, I paid
$600. Yeah, beautiful. So when you got married, now you're going on, how many years would that be now?
90.
That was 90.
About 35 years, though.
Yeah.
Like
what's the secret, you think, to happy longevity as well as a happy marriage?
Well, I think she gave me my space and I gave her hers.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah.
None of this jealous thing and all that, you know?
Right.
Like, you know?
Yeah.
I think that's one of the keys to it.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, she was working, I was working, so we didn't get to see much of each other anytime.
You
because,
visit.
Yeah, I worked at night, she worked in the day.
Mm-hmm.
She wasn't driving, then I would drive her to work in the morning, come back up, cook, do the things I got to do. Go back and pick her up in the evening, and then go back down to Treasure Island. Then after I left there, it was the Hyatt, Rum Point. So the same thing.
Yes.
But after a while, then she got her license and bought a little car. And she had her transportation and I had mine.
Yes.
But I think that has a lot to do with it, you know, giving each other their space.
Yeah. And communicating with each other.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Now, in a lot of things, we can't see eye to eye with because I think it's the age different.
Yes.
Yeah. I was going to be her father,
mm-hmm.
you know, 19 years older.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
If I'm thinking about painting a house, she's thinking about going to fix her hair. Let's put it that way. That's just an example. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yeah, I discovered that myself. And you know what I said after a while? I said, okay, you got to set some ground rules for probably the second round to work, right? No more than 10 years older and younger might be a problem because guys mature differently.
Yeah.
So you got to be very careful going too young. I think for women and men in particular, but you know, back in, you know, 30, 40 years ago, a lot was different as well, right. Even in terms of relationships and, you know, I guess you could probably get on a lot easier with people than now. There's always so much drama out there, I tell you.
Boy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you were mentioning earlier before we started recording that you actually knew my dad. So I'm always interested in stories about him because I know he was a wild one. Doing all sorts of stuff. And I'm sure if you're a bartender on more than one occasion, you would have seen him.
Well, no.
No?
No, because he never used to come down around the clubs, the hotels and things like that.
Okay.
He used to hang around at the other bars, I guess.
Yeah, more like the local
bars
and stuff.
I only used to see him when I used to go by his workplace.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And have a few drinks there with him, you know.
Right, okay.
Yeah, but he must have used to hang around the local places.
Yeah. Marinka Town and stuff
like
that.
Took that out of my mouth, yeah.
Yeah.
I think on one or two occasions I saw him there. That was long before I was recording and singing. But I went there a couple of times and went up on stage, you know, with this band, Elon Parr's band.
Okay.
And sang a few songs and I saw him there a couple of times like that.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Everybody knows he was a mechanic.
But he was,
pretty much fix anything.
Oh, yeah. He's a nice guy, too.
Mm-hmm.
Nice fellow.
Yeah. So you got around a little bit, hanging out with some of the Georgetowners. Do you have a lot of friends, like, in West Bay as well? Or you
oh, yeah,
mix
all
with
over.
Everybody?
Yeah, all over.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Where your parents were from the Bronx, so were their parents also from the Bronx?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, my grandmother on my mother's side was from Jamaica.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
And she came here and she had two daughters.
Mm-hmm.
One by my grandfather and one by another man. Mm-hmm. At the point.
Okay.
So my mother was legitimate.
Ah, yeah. Okay.
He got married years later and, you know, had his children and he never did pay us any money.
Oh, my goodness.
But I guess he loved her because he registered her in the name of Carter,
which was
his surname, you know?
Yeah.
But he had a big store and came back. He was a very popular man in Kimberly.
Oh, really? Yeah. Okay.
Never gave us any.
Yeah, wow.
So my grandmother, she went back to Jamaica, I think it was about 1954. But she got married after that, a local man, but they didn't have any kids.
Mm-hmm.
And then she sold her property to her husband's nephew.
Mm-hmm.
And he built a big house on the property. She only had a little house there.
Mm-hmm.
She must have wanted to go back home, so the money that he gave her.
Yeah.
He said it was going was £50, and that was a lot of money them days.
Mm-hmm.
So she went back home and we never heard no more from her.
Really?
Well, her other daughter used to contact her sometimes.
Yes.
But she lost track of her too, so we never did hear anything.
So she moved back to Jamaica then?
Yeah, that was from the early 50s.
Yeah. What part of Jamaica do you remember?
Clarendon.
Clarendon.
So from.
Okay.
And every time I ask Jamaicans, and I say, where are you from? And if they say Clarendon, I didn't want a connection with them because
it could be found.
Could be found.
Absolutely. Yeah, and it's a small world. Oh, yeah. Yeah. That's very interesting. Interesting story there. And then your father's people then, they've had years and years of being brokers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm. Very nice.
My grandfather was originally from Belize, I heard, Martin. Mm-hmm. And he married one of the local women.
Mm-hmm.
And they got married.
Yeah.
That was my grandfather. Well, he left. We had nobody heard any more about it.
Oh, really?
Yeah. My other grandmother, then she died from back in, I think it was 54 she died.
Yeah, okay.
I must have took my black hair from her.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Yeah, that's because she was 71 when she died, and her hair was jet black. My eldest sister is 88, and her hair is jet black. And so is mine, and it not dyed. You can see not dyed.
Yeah.
My friends tease me, but I dyed my hair. I said, no, you can't look at that. That ain't die here.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
We must have got it from her, you know?
Yes, wow. I got more gray hair than you, and I'm only 50.
Sue got more than me, too. My wife's in. She'd be 62 this year, but she got some gray hair,
I said. Yeah. Oh, my goodness.
You probably know my youngest sister, Marie Martin.
Miss Marie.
They just named the school.
They just named the school after her.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
That might be
I don't know her personally, but I definitely know who she is.
Yeah, she's my baby sister.
Okay, beautiful. But, yes, you must be proud of her.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, that was by my father's last husband, you know. And you probably know Lorna, too, Lorna Bush.
Miss Lorna's your sister?
Sister, too.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good, of course. You know, Caymanians are so mixed up and
I know
all of the place that I don't always put the connections together because I grew up overseas. But when people start saying, "Yeah, this person's family to me," I go, "Wow, yeah, it's a small world after all."
Yeah, but you got a lot of family on your mother's side.
Yeah.
Okay. No, I don't know much about your daddy. So
yeah, all over. Yeah. You know, I did this. You know, they have these 23andMe tests now, like genetic testing and whatever. And I was kind of surprised to find out that I have a lot of West Bay connections.
Really?
And it's actually on my father's side, his grandmother, which would have been then my great grandmother, was a West Bayer. So that's where the West Bay connection. I must have family there, born in West Bay.
Yeah, well, I got on West Bay too. His family because Dilbert, my grandmother was a Dilbert.
She's a Dilbert.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's where her father originated from.
Yeah.
So they did it, now they found it.
Yeah. So, like you said, you were asking people, it's funny you say that, like, what part of Jamaica you're from? My thing was, I don't know if I could ever marry a Caymanian because they're probably a cousin.
Yeah, probably. You know?
So, yes, my dear. But, you know, it's amazing how Cayman has these connections. Belize, Honduras, even in my thing, it says there's a connection in the Bay Islands, Belize. You know, my grandfather, my mother's side, was actually from St. Elizabeth.
Okay.
And then he left Jamaica when he was 13 years old, traveled and did his thing, you know, and eventually came to Cayman. So lots of mixed up all over the region and all over the world. Mm-hmm. Yep.
I probably got some family from Honduras too.
Oh, yeah.
I've been there quite a few times, Rotan.
Mm-hmm.
And La Saiba, because the song I did, Letter from Sea. That was a big hit over there.
Oh, yeah? Okay.
You probably heard that one, too?
No, I don't think I have.
It's a talking one.
Okay.
You know, but it's... Barefoot and I wrote it together. I told him how the sea life was, you know. And,
right.
And we wrote it. And one of the biggest things for a person at sea is to get a letter from home.
Right.
And if you don't get that letter, I see captains going ashore and drinking and getting drunk because he didn't get a letter, you know?
Yeah.
That was a big thing.
To know that people missed you back home, basically.
Exactly, and you wanted to know the news of what was going on home, you know, and all that.
Of course.
It's called Letter from Sea.
Yeah.
But it's a talking thing. Uh-huh. But the chorus says, got no letters here today. Though I'm 1,000 miles away, uh-huh. I'll be back. I've got 22 more days. The Hondurans calls it 22 more days.
Okay.
Because I understand that when they go getting shrimp and thing,
they
go for 22 days and then they come back. So they call the song 22. But it's a very touching song and make you cry. I mean, and me recording it, I cry.
It's
a very touching song.
Yeah. Well, who did you have writing letters to you when you were at sea?
Well, I had a girlfriend.
Yeah, she wrote you letters.
Yeah, and a lot of people probably thought that I was writing that song about her.
Uh-huh.
But no. I was getting too much letters from her. Yeah, that was maybe something that had been going on. I was getting too much letters. I wasn't having a problem getting letters.
she liked to write a lot. Oh my goodness. Mm-mm.
Well, I think it was writing a lot was the reason. Maybe it was other things making me feel good by sending out writing all these letters.
Yeah, of course. She wanted to keep you in love. I understand.
So that was the biggest record I did. I got a little one. Can up there?
Oh yeah, we gotta go over there in a second. I see you got cassette tapes and everything.
It's called a gold record, but Barefoot painted it.
He painted it gold.
Sprayed it, yeah. He sold about 3,000 copies, you know. He saved
that's good.
In the States. Look at how much it has to sell to be a gold record.
Of course.
And here you only need about a couple hundred.
Yeah. Wow. That's amazing. Yeah, we'll go over to that. That little section looks interesting. We'll go over there in just a second.
I got so much cassettes there, and I don't know what I'm going to do with them.
Yeah, keep listening. Keep listening to the music.
Yeah, but I mean, my cassettes don't play anymore. I got a double one there and a double one there.
Your cassette player not working?
No, they're going bad.
Oh my gosh.
And I guess they've been up there so long now that they seized up.
Yeah. Oh my goodness. Wow.
I guess if I decide to go back home, I'll have to do a sale.
Yeah.
You know, garage sale and sell them all.
How many songs do you think you've written in your career?
I wrote about, I guess, 15 or 20.
Okay.
But the Barefoot Man wrote most of my songs. He's a good writer.
He's a good writer.
Yeah, he mightn't be the greatest singer, but he's a good writer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And which one is your favorite?
My songs?
Yes.
Well, I did a few songs that were written, recorded by other artists, you know.
Okay.
And my favorite country singer was George Jones.
Right.
And I recorded that song, Walk Through This World With Me.
Yes.
And that, I guess, would be my favorite song.
Favorite, yeah.
I even sang that to my wife when we got married.
Ah.
I made her put it on my recording, you know, and then I lip sang to her.
Okay.
And she's like, she didn't know what we're doing.
And George Jones, he's the one who sings the Cold Hard Truth.
That's it.
Yeah,
that might be. Stopped loving her today.
My show is named after his
Yes, song. I know.
Yeah. Very good.
He's gone down in history as the greatest country singer that ever lived, man.
Mm-hmm.
He put the feelings in the song like he lived them. And believe you me, he lived a lot of them too.
Yeah.
You know, with marriages and breaking up and drinking and all that.
Yeah.
And a lot of people wrote songs to suit him.
Right.
And they pitched them to him, you know?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
But of the songs that I wrote, I can't say that I have any special one that I really liked more than the other ones, you know.
Yes. Yep. Cayman Cowboy. What a life. So you're 80 years old now. I reckon you at least go to 100, 105, so you still got lots of time left. What do you have? Now I want to talk about this because you did mention that you had a little scare with COVID, so you actually caught the Wow!
But before that, I want to say this: my eldest brother died in 2019.
Okay.
He died November and August, October. He was 80. So I keep thinking about that. I said maybe I'm not going over 80.
No, man, you want to go over it. You want to go over it.
Yeah, I got the COVID. My wife got it. And it never did her a thing.
Wow.
And she gave it to me.
Mm-mm.
And I was in the hospital about a week, I guess, and came out. I don't think I was ever rid of it because it wasn't long after that when I got it again. I had to go back into the hospital. And it left me with the heart failure. And
when did you catch it early on? That was March 2020, I think, is when we kind of went down into lockdown.
The 3 years went by and I never got it.
Oh.
Yeah, I just got it November, yeah, before last November, I think it was.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So you went all that time and never
got it.
Wow.
I took the 3 shots too. Some people say that's what gives it to you.
Wow.
The booster shot, they say.
You know what they've discovered is that there's a thing called long haul COVID, and that you're more likely to get, you know, there's a link between the vaccine and some things, but they haven't gone as far as saying this causes it. But they said what they do know is that the cause of it from getting the actual virus itself is worse. So some people have what they call myocarditis, this heart thing, right? Say it's one in whatever from the vaccine. It's 6 times that for the people who get the virus itself. So the virus is more deadly, even catching heart conditions and everything else in the vaccine.
And they say that once you take the shots, at least you can catch it, but you won't die. But I know people who died.
It depends on how sick they were.
Yes.
Yeah, there's no guarantees in life. That's for sure.
So they're giving the shots out again?
Yeah, I mean, you can get boosters. I think the recommendation now is for people who are older, just like the flu shot. If you're older and if you have certain conditions, immune compromise, you know, that you need to be careful with. Otherwise, the general population has built up enough immunity now. So, I mean, I took my three shots and I never...
So you never got it?
Oh, I got it. In fact...
It didn't do you much?
You know what I found with it? It was very strange because how I knew it was something different is one day I had a headache. They had parliaments. At first I was thinking the parliamentarians gave me a headache. But then even after I stopped watching them, the headache didn't go away. I said, man, this is really weird. Like, I'm not a person who gets headaches like that often. And this one wasn't easing up. I took something for it. It just wasn't going away. So I went and lie down. And actually it was my helper that said to me, I bet you got that COVID in it. Because that's how mine started, with a headache. No sore throat. You know, normally if you get a little cold or flu starts and sore throat. Nope, it was a headache. And I was lying down. I said, really? I said, well, I'm going to test it. Sure enough, I tested positive. But the crazy thing was, my little girl and husband had it the November before. The two of them got it. I sleep in bed with her every night. I never caught it.
Hmm.
Yeah, the two of them had it. They were all around the place. Didn't catch it. So it's just one of those things, you know. But it didn't really do me too bad. But I also started a course of the viral treatment that they had for it at the time.
Okay.
The doctor started me in that. So it wasn't really that bad. Yeah. I'm glad to hear that you're okay now. But you said...
Yeah, I'm pretty good.
Yeah. Yeah, some people say long-haul COVID for years afterwards look like they're going to be impacted by it. Just one of those things, but I guess we got to be thankful.
But I still believe that a lot of these people that are dying now,
mm-hmm.
even if they didn't die and it was COVID that killed them, I believe a lot of them, their organs got affected from the COVID and, you know?
Yeah.
Like how I got affected from it.
Yes.
And that was the cause of the death. That's my belief.
Yeah. Well, they
especially the older ones, you know.
Yeah, no, I've read, it's very interesting. I mean, they're still learning a bit about this COVID business, but they said that it's the only virus that they have seen that has impacted every major organ in the body.
Hmm.
Lungs, heart, everything.
The whole thing.
Kidneys, everything.
Yeah.
So this virus was something different for sure. Ah, boy. But I guess we're on the other side a little bit now, learning to live with it.
I believe these things happen every so many years to try to kill off some of the population.
Yeah.
Got to work out those people.
Yeah. So we were going to talk a little bit about, what were we going to talk about? I guess we're not even, we went to the COVID situation, but we're going to talk about something else. Your memory probably better than mine. Anyway, yes, 80 years old. What's the plan? You've been retired all these years. What's an average day like for you? What do you do? You say you stopped driving a couple years ago.
Yeah, I don't do nothing much now.
Yeah, you just take it easy.
Yeah, now years ago.
Yeah.
I
you listen to the radio.
I used to clean my yard and thing, you know.
Okay.
But I was in the back some years ago. I think that was 2019 too.
Mm-hmm.
And I fell down one of those things that you park the car by.
Oh.
I bucked my foot against
my gosh.
And fell over it. And it hit this, and this is connected to the spine. I was at Shedders for a week.
Oh my gosh.
That was bad. So from then
I take it easy.
Yeah, and I couldn't clean the yard anymore. I had to pay somebody to do it. But I used to do it. I love doing it, you know? So, but I don't do nothing in the morning. I'm just going to the laptop and look at Facebook.
Listen to the Cold Hard Truth every once in a while.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
Watches things on the TV and all like that, yeah.
Yeah.
But I was painting some of my doors the other day. I painted them myself, you know. Because this whole house needs paint inside and out.
Mm-hmm.
But everything costs so much these days.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You lived a good life, Mr. Andy. What advice would you have for young people? You know, I always like to ask this question because I think we have so much that we can learn from our elders. What advice would you give young people today coming up in this world?
Well, you need to have ambition, I know that. And go to work. Mm-hmm. Get a job. And get your own little apartment or whatever. Get away from your family, you know, to be independent. And you don't know how to get married. I mean, that was old. old thing, but not now.
Yes.
You can even have a kid if you want before, without getting married.
Yeah.
But take care of yourself, work, and for yourself, not a kind of family thing, mm-hmm. you know?
Yes.
And love people, and have respect for people, you know, and all that sort of thing. And, yeah.
Yeah. I said this morning, hard work never killed nobody. Somebody said, well, I think it might have killed some people because of stress. I said, no, y'all will be all right.
I know a guy from Peter Costa. He's a lawyer now.
Uh-huh.
His father used to write him, get up and do something, you know, when he was a teenager.
Yes.
You're too lazy. He said, well, Dad, I never heard that lazy kill anybody, yeah?
Oh, my goodness. I tell you. So I want us to go over here into this little section and look at some of your little cassettes and stuff like that. All right. We got a lot of cassettes here.
Oh my goodness, yeah. Look down in here, all of these, you know.
A whole collection there of cassettes.
All of there.
Wow. I see Hank Williams Jr. I see Ricky Van Shelton. Oh my gosh, lots of, all of it looks like country music to me.
All of it, yeah.
Alan Jackson.
Everything.
Oh yeah, John Anderson. Who's that, Merle Haggard?
Oh yeah,
Merle. Oh yeah, mm-hmm. Beautiful.
This is another little thing I got from McKeever Bush named years ago.
Oh, yes. The first annual premier award for the arts back in 2009. That's beautiful.
Alicia Keys, I think she came here.
Yes, she did a concert.
Yes, and that's where I got this award that night. And then nice. I got this one here. God, this is heavy.
Uh-huh. The Cayman Music and Entertainment Association, over 40 years of consistent contribution. Yeah. Beautiful.
And then I got this thing here from... Estevan, what's his name? Horacio?
Oh, Horacio.
He did that for me.
It's like a little sculpture.
Yeah, it needs to be, it's loosened up, you know.
Oh, beautiful. Mm-hmm. Very nice. Wonderful.
And I got the certificate of honor.
Oh, wow, that's beautiful.
Yeah, I got that too.
Oh, wow, look at that. Queen Elizabeth in the name of Her Majesty. Mm-hmm. Mr. Andy Elton Martin.
Yeah.
That was 2008. Wow. Absolutely beautiful. Who is this? Who are these beautiful ladies here?
That's my wife.
That's your wife?
Yeah, she was
gorgeous.
Vince was pretty.
She's still pretty, I'm sure.
So we're getting a picture over there.
This is your... Oh, wow. Look at you. Wow, that's gorgeous. Look at you. Very beautiful. That was the one in Vegas?
Yeah.
Wow, that looks proper.
Yeah.
Very nice. Does this thing work?
My God. I bought this in Nashville. It must have been about 40 years ago.
Uh-huh.
This works all.
It still works?
Oh, yeah. All the time.
Really being effective.
I has it on a lot, too, but...
Yeah.
I had to cut it off before you came.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Oh, this worked good. That's an old... that's an antique.
Yes, of course.
I bought that last many years ago.
Oh my gosh, look at that. Absolutely gorgeous. Wow. And this looks like somebody did this beautiful painting of you.
Yes, that was my nephew Miguel. Miguel Martin.
He
was head of the airport, you know, for some years, but he retired last month. And this is a picture in front of my brother's bar. He had one bar up there. He sold it.
Mm-hmm.
Collier's Place. And this was in front of his place.
This was in Cayman Brac?
Cayman Brac, yeah.
Okay.
That's a nice
beautiful
picture.
Yeah, that's very, very beautiful. Very nice.
Yeah, see some of my cassettes.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yes.
Got them all about.
So how many albums have you done?
I think I did about five.
About five, okay.
Yeah, and each one had about 10 or 12 songs.
Yeah.
So this is one, you know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. This one, Andy and Friends. This is Island Country.
Yeah, that's a mixture of myself and Chuck and Barry and Barefoot Man. And
yeah.
Different ones, you know?
Right. When was the last time you actually recorded any music?
I guess that was about 5 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
5 years ago, I did a gospel.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's the last time that I recorded.
Yeah, nice.
And I recorded since then.
Very beautiful. Love it. Well, I'm going to get some of your music and play into this interview because I know people are going to want to hear some of your songs.
But I can give you a CD. I got some there.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Really appreciate you.
Sure. Pleasure.
Yeah. Wonderful. Beautiful. We got to get you sorted out with a cassette player, so hopefully you can listen to some of those still.
Those cassettes.
Oh, yeah.
I'll be back. I've got 22 more days. Hi, this is Andy Martin.
And I'm the Barefoot Man, and we'll be back in Utila on June the 15th to watch Honduras play in the World Cup. And we're all going to be hanging around the Coral Beach Village. And we're going to have a great time because we'll play some music for you at the same time. So come see us. Get your tickets early, okay? All right. She's black like a ching ching. Oh, but she's sweet. She's built like a breadfruit. She got plenty of meat. Oh, that's how they like her. The bigger the better. Lots of woman there. She got curlers in she hair. Me, I work at Delaware Super Service. Specialize in service all the way. But there's only one thing that really bugs me. Is this Englishman that comes here every day. He says, give me 50 cents worth of regular. Check my old tool, if you don't mind. Put some air in my tires, won't you, mister? I must hurry. It's almost secret conference time. Delaware Super Service, we have fun now. Drink 30, 40 greenies every day. Just about the time we're all relaxing. Up drives this crazy man every day. He says, give me 50 cents worth of regular. Check my oil, fuel if you don't mind. Put some air in my tires, won't you, mister? I must hurry, there's almost secret conference time. He's a caveman cowboy, and it might seem strange, but he calls his island his home on the range. He don't wear no six gun, no, that ain't his style. He just wears a great big caveman cowboy smile. You can see him riding underneath the coconut tree. There ain't no cows to rustle, but there's girls so nice and pretty. He's a caveman cowboy, and it might seem strange, but he calls his island his home on the range. He don't wear no six gun, no, that ain't his style. He just wears a great big caveman cowboy smile. People call him stubby, and anywhere he can be seen. It's hard to be a cowboy, but that's always been his dream. He's a caveman cowboy, and it might seem strange, but he calls his island
is home on the range. Peter wears no six guns, though that ain't his style. He just wears a great big game and cowboy smile. He don't wear no six guns, no, that ain't his style. He just wears a great big game and cowboy smile. Stop just wears a great big game and cowboy smile. Got no letters here today, though I'm a thousand miles away. I'll be back, I've got 22 more days. Hello, sweetheart. Our ship just pulled into filling with a load of oil from the Gulf when the ship's agent brought the mail on board. You should have seen all the smiling faces of the messmen and the oilers. Why, even the first engineer got a few letters from back home this trip. But for me, it was the same old story. Just like the last two ports we've hit. Nothing. I know it's hard on you, me being away for almost a whole year now. But that's the life of a seaman. I don't know if you've been counting the days, but I have. There's only 22 more days left, and I'll be home. You know, I've walked this old tanker from bow to stern a thousand times, wondering what you might be doing on a night like this. I know it's hard on you, me being a seaman. Hell, it's like we're never home. Well, it's hard on me too. Every port we dock at, there are a thousand girls waiting to keep her company. But they don't really care about us. All they care about is that roll of money in our pockets. Now, I'm not saying that I don't hit the bars. Sure I do. Everybody does. From the captain to the messman. The booze seems to help somehow. And those sad songs on the jukebox always remind me of home. The National Bulk Ships agent asked me if I'd sign up for another year after this trip. But I told him, no way. There's only 22 more days left, and I'll be home, and that's it. Please meet me at the airport, sweetheart, and bring the kids along with you. Oh, I can't wait to see them again. And if you have room in that old Ford of ours, pick Mom up on the way, will you? I guess I'd better close this letter off now so I can get it to you. There's only 22 more days left, and I'll be home. Got no letters here today, though I'm a thousand miles away. I'll be back, I've got 22 more days. I'll be back, I've got 22